All right, we're live. Hello, everyone. Welcome to Christian Hangout number 30. I can't believe we've made it to this many. 30. It's like a milestone of some sort. And so far, there's only three of us. We have Luminette Saul and William Scott with us again, both returning, but two of the best people we got. So it's good.
Thanks, Ian.
So
yeah, that's kind of a lot. That's kind of a lot of pressure.
Yeah, we got to live up to everybody's expectations now.
Yeah.
So I just posted this tweet. Let me just pin it real quick.
I'm going to do the same.
This is real exciting for everybody. Okay. So, anyway, what's been going on with you guys? Have you been, how was, Easter?
I'll let William go.
Oh, yeah. Easter was good. Yeah. We had a good, I got through Lent. Okay. This year, I guess not as, I was busy. I was trying to do some writing on my blog and it kind of fell apart and I still haven't gotten back to it. Set myself up a project which I haven't quite finished. So, but the Easter was good. My daughter went to church for the first time in probably a couple of years with me.
Oh, really?
She said and my son also came, who doesn't, she used to go to that church with me. Anyway, getting a little complexity of my family, but she actually used to work in the nursery looking after the, and she hadn't been for a long time and was kind of, you know, always signaling against it, and I kind of endured this for quite a while, and then she'd said she'd been dreaming about going to church over the last little while, and I said, well, I guess probably, you know, maybe you should go. And so anyway, then Easter came up. I said, Easter might be a good time. And she said, yeah, sure. And she just was there. And, you know, it's an Anglican church, so liturgical stuff. And so she was just citing, you know, spouting off the liturgy the whole time without any,
wow,
like she never missed a beat. Like she knew it. She remembered it all. And it really seemed to like, yeah, that seemed to be kind of important to her in a way that she knew that. And that was sort of part of her, right? So I was pretty happy about that. So that was a bonus for me over Christmas or Easter. Sorry.
So, is being a Christmas and Easter Christian better than not being a Christian at all?
I think so. Yeah, I told her that actually. I said, yeah, at Christmas, I told her, you know, it's your day to go. You know, there's lots of young women like you that only show up once a year or twice a year. Because at least if you're doing that, then you might, you know, it might become something more. So, anyway.
Yeah.
Well, mine was really special. Just because, unfortunately, I've over the last year I've been extremely sick, and I missed a lot of Mass, and it was just one of the worst symptoms I was dealing with was brain fog, where, I mean, it's just, you can't concentrate, you can't focus on anything. And so I, unfortunately I missed a lot of Mass. So, it was getting to the Easter Mass and receiving the Eucharist. And I went to confession the week before. It was just spectacular. I was so happy. Although I wanted to go to the Easter Vigil Mass, which is actually, it's the greatest in the Catholic Church. It's the most important Mass of the year. It's the night before Easter Sunday. And I planned on going to a SSPX service.
Oh, sweet.
I guess the brain fog isn't completely gone because I thought it was at a chapel that was reasonably close to my home, and luckily I checked a few hours before it was going to happen, but it was actually 3 hours away. So I missed the Easter Vigil, but it was wonderful. It was just you know, going when you go through anything that really tests you, you know, physically, mentally, emotionally, spiritually, and that's what happened to all of those areas for me. And you're just really beaten down, and you manage to somehow hold on to God, and you get through it. I guess if you're lucky, this is how it happened for me. You get a greater appreciation for what's really important, and you know, that's how I felt in Mass last Sunday. You know, that I made it here, and you know, I feel better. You just forget about, you know, a lot of the day-to-day things that kind of pale in significance to, you know, just being reasonably healthy and being able to exercise your faith. So it was nice. I was very happy.
Cool. So your regular church doesn't have a vigil?
Well, no. And it's because I go to the Latin Mass. And so it's kind of a struggle unless you live close to a metropolitan area to have a parish that has just a regular program for the Latin Mass where, you know, all the holy days are observed and you know, you have the same priest celebrating the Mass. So, you know, for us, you know, we, most of us were, if you hear a squeaking noise in the background, that's my baby. No, it's my dog. It's actually my dog.
It kind of sounds like a baby crying.
Yeah. That's her toy. Of course she's got like five different toys and she picks up the one that makes the most noise. Hold on 1 second. I'm going to get her another toy.
Hey, I see Gray Rebel just joined us. Welcome, Gray Rebel.
Thanks, sir.
Hey, since this is your first time with us, would you like to introduce yourself and tell us a little bit about your Christian background?
Sure.
Put you on the spot right when you join, but that's usually what we do around here.
Yeah, well, I'm kind of used to that. Well, I am the guy behind the scenes of Good Morning White America, and as far as Christian background goes, I grew up independent fundamental Baptist, you know, dispensational, King James only, and then in high school started going through everything that I believed, and it was through researching King James onlyism and some issues surrounding that I ran across Reformed theology, and so I guess now I'd be consider myself Reformed Baptist. That's kind of me in a nutshell, I suppose.
Welcome, Gray Rebel. It's good to have you. I love the show.
Oh, I'm glad.
You know, we actually did have a show a while back where it was about the South, and we were discussing Christianity in the South, and that might have been a good one to have you on way back when. That was, I think, number 18.
But oh, yeah.
That was one where we kept getting off topic because people wanted to talk about Rahoa, but I try to avoid that kind of stuff on here just because I think it can be a bit distracting from the real issues.
Oh, speaking of that, you know whose birthday it is today, right?
Oh, come on now.
I'm sorry. I'll leave it at that. Yeah. I apologize.
I didn't choose this date because of that reason, just for the record, so.
Uh-huh, yep.
Yeah, that's actually right. It's funny, I actually literally didn't even realize what day it was until I was sending out the invitations for this. So, and I'm sorry, I
couldn't resist one small provocative remark.
It's okay.
I'll leave it at that.
I did make a joke about the date at work, but I had to leave it a little obscure as to the actual intention.
Yeah, but I think it's just a smoke weed day or whatever it is.
Yeah, that's what people normally think of. Yeah,
I'll say something like, you know, I don't, you know, what is it with these hippies and their obsession with Hitler? You know, and his birthday. I can't make that connection. And people usually don't get it.
Oh.
Yeah. No, most people aren't. Yeah, well, I don't know. I mean, I think people must be by now more aware of it. But anyway, that is Hitler. I mean, it's Uncle Adolf's birthday. My Uncle Adolf. It's happening, Ian. You can't control it. It's over.
Yeah. It's all right. Hold on a second.
I was just this close to asking if you've seen Kyle, you know, if he's gonna show up tonight.
I didn't invite Kyle.
Okay. Yeah. I was just wondering.
Unless somebody's real name is Kyle and I don't know it. Who's this Kyle? I don't know anyone by Kyle. By the name of Kyle. Okay, that was a bad impression. Nobody will get that. Did anyone get that?
The impression? No.
I was doing a very bad impression of Doc Brown from Back to the Future.
Ah, okay. Yep.
Who's this Kyle? I don't know anyone by the name of Kyle.
That was better. That was much better.
Yeah, I put more effort into that one.
With confidence, yes, Ian. If you're going to do it, you have to do it.
What in the name of Sir Isaac H. Newton happened here? Yeah, that's like my favorite movie of all time. Yeah, it is. I've probably seen it like 100 times, like all three parts. I'm not even joking.
Wow.
So I can quote pretty much the entire thing.
Wow.
So how was your Easter, Grey Rebel?
It was very good. Had a good church service and then time with family.
Unfortunately, I didn't make it to church on Easter, but I did do the Good Morning White America Bible study, so that was good.
Ah.
Oh, you joined you're in the Bible study?
Yeah, there are several different groups. I know, I guess we talked about them on a previous hangout.
Mm-hmm.
Which group are you in?
I'm with Clement Pulaski. I'm in the Central Time Zone one, even though I don't live in the Central Time Zone, but it works.
Okay. Because I'm on the Eastern Time with Hans.
Okay.
Even though I am in
Central. Do you lead one by yourself? Or
no, I do not.
Okay. Yeah, I think it's definitely a good project about making connections and forming churches where we aren't just complete race cucks. And hopefully it'll grow into something bigger. I think it's definitely a good idea. Seems like every time the Christian section of the alt-right starts doing stuff, I like to get involved. So I think we do need to make connections.
Yes, mm-hmm. Absolutely. We should start networking with an eye, you know, towards the future, you know, just to be prepared to, you know, do what Christians have always done, you know, in the face of tumultuous times, in the face of not just adversity, but persecution. You know, it's a, you know, I'm traditional Catholic, and there are, you know, there are pastors out there that are not shy about, you know, voicing their opinion that we could be facing persecution relatively soon. So I think it's a good time for us to network, you know, people who you know, we will need to rely on each other.
Mm-hmm.
I did have an idea for a topic, if I might suggest it. Is that all right, Ian?
Okay, what is it?
I was wondering what people think about, you know, in light of the you know, the escalating friction between Nazis, which is everyone, you know, who's left or I'm sorry, right of Noam Chomsky, and Antifa. And I was wondering what you guys think about looking at Antifa as pretty much unwitting, but nonetheless, as agents of Satan, you know, as you know, because Satan loves chaos and Satan loves to destroy. And I mean, it's the opposite of Christendom, which is order and virtue. And so it's just, I don't know. I thought I might throw that out there.
I don't know a lot about Antifa except what I hear from listening to different podcasts.
Well, I don't either.
But I mean, it is an interesting phenomenon how it seems like it seems like a lot of them are, from what I hear, they tend to be very broken people from like maybe privileged backgrounds who just have nothing, no purpose in life. And I don't know what to make of people like that, if they're that dysfunctional that they just want to start becoming revolutionaries. But it was kind of funny on the latest Daily Show, they were talking about the Antifa, how they refuse to organize because they believe that it's like they believe hierarchy is evil, so they have to just be
homes
of affiliation. Which is funny because I have seen, it does seem like there really are some leftists who think that like man lives in a natural state of egalitarianism, but some evil oppressive people invented this concept called hierarchy so they could enslave people or something. And it's just really absurd, of course, but that's how these people think. So I don't know. I wonder if there's some way to reach people like that, if there's some way to like get them before this sort of like messianic leftist impulse takes hold of them.
Yeah, I don't know on that. I like to think of them as the followers of Baal, who, learning that their God is wrong and false, become ever more zealous for him.
You think of them as what now?
The followers of Baal.
Oh, Baal. Okay, yeah. I thought you said ale.
Oh, no.
Yeah, I mean, and, you know, just as a quick aside, I you know, regarding their lack of disorganization, I've seen some recent tweets that seem to indicate that they're looking towards becoming more disciplined and actually, you know, getting some training and et cetera. Which I still I don't think, if it comes down to, you know, you can't. It's very difficult to fight a well organized group of virtuous men. I mean, they're not the communists of Weimar era Germany. You know, as Mike Enoch said, you know, they would probably be among some of the first that were liquidated under a true communist regime. But yeah, I mean, absent Christ, you know, absent, you know, living your life for Christ, you have to fill that void with something. And it just really, you know, I think Grey Rebel has a good point, you know, but they are, you know, throwing their fervor into something else, and it's just the whole thing is pretty satanic to me. You know, it's just, I mean, again, like I said, it's unwitting, you know, it's not like, but I mean, you know, it's, you know, the left is in many ways is satanic. I mean, they are working for the forces of disorder and chaos, and these are pretty, in some ways they're pretty cataclysmic times. You know, the mainstream in what is ostensibly the most civilized part of the world, you know, are kind of, you know, apologizing for these people and supporting them.
That would be E. Michael Jones' thesis on it, I would suppose. That all form revolution is in fact satanic, because it's at war with Logos. So.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yep.
Does anybody have anything else to say about Antifa or any other thoughts of them?
I just thought that people, there was kind of a movement which they called themselves anti-Antifa. I think they should have just called themselves Fa. Anyway.
I know that does make things more simple.
It does, yes. Anyway.
Well, yeah, but I mean, they're not necessarily saying that they support what they oppose. They're just saying they oppose their opposition.
Yeah, I know, but well, I think those. I think the maybe those people weren't fascists, maybe, or didn't, you know what the word meant or something. Anyway, yeah, it's true. It's true. You're correct, Ian, but it just seemed a little more efficient, straight to the point.
I will say that it's kind of interesting. It's kind of fascinating. Again, you know, like when I think these people do kind of imagine themselves to be, you know, kind of like the redeemers for, you know, the communists in Germany who were, you know, pretty much steamrolled. And they are so much different. You know, they're just so much more degenerate. I think that the communists in Weimar era Germany did, you know, they supported degeneracy, and it was a, you know, was a largely Jewish movement, but I don't think they imbibed, you know, the hemlock quite as, you know, happily as these people do. You know, I mean, you look at them, and they're just, and Ian, I think you had a good point. I mean, these are people that are broken, so it's, I don't know, the whole thing fascinates me. You know, I'm in my middle ages, and you know, I'm not really, I don't see myself, you know, wanting to get into the streets with these people. You know, the work that I do is more oriented towards art and design, but it is fascinating, it's interesting to wonder where it's going to end up.
Yeah. I guess we really need to have things available for people who are searching for something, though, so that
yes,
they can channel their desires into something positive and not just fighting quote unquote fascists.
Gray Rebel, I'm in the Northeast. I'm in New England. How's it down in the South? I don't know how deep you are, but you know, how's the you know, the far left militancy where you are?
I haven't seen too much of it personally. Now, there were minor demonstrations with the Black Lives Matter up in, I think, Nashville, maybe 6 months to a year ago. There's a whole lot of non-Southern people here and non-whites that don't have any ties, obviously, to being here. So, especially with the universities, it's bringing a whole lot of left-wing people. So I imagine it'll eventually come down here. But as of yet, not too much that I've noticed anyway.
Well, that's good. I mean, even up here, you know, there are people like myself, you know, we respect the South, you know, the traditional South.
Right.
And it's, you know, what's even more interesting to me is it seemed like, you know, up until the election of Trump, obviously, and then Kyle Chapman, aka based Stickman, in the first Berkeley skirmish there, it seems like the right, you know, it was almost like the, what's that Kipling poem, The Wrath of the Saxon?
The Awakened Saxon.
Yeah. It was kind of like that. You know, it's like, you know, the right kind of, I mean, these, you know, the Antifa and maybe the people who just are kind of LARPing along with them, you know, they kind of had their, they could just, you know, run rampant without any true resistance. And they were essentially just, you know, they were beating up, you know, boomer age people and you know, just your average kind of, I guess, middle age or older patriot. And it seems like just now, like, especially since that this Berkeley situation on Saturday, just now, you know, the right is beginning to resist. And what I worry about is that once it becomes clear to, you know, our elitist overlords, you know, that you know, the right is mobilizing and, you know, is more organized and you know, and usually wins, you know, I wonder, I wonder if that'll be the kind of the, if that'll light the fuse of, you know, really cracking down on the internet. And, cause it seems like things are happening, for me at least, you know, a little bit more quickly than I kind of imagined them happening a couple of years ago. So it's, I don't know, that seems like the right is finally now, you know, awakening. The right began to hate, you know, it seems like that's just starting to happen right now. And so, I don't, you know, just what Richard Spencer did, you know, being organized, making sure you had a bodyguard. And, you know, once we start doing these things, you know, we do it well. And so it's, I don't know. I guess I'll conclude with this. It's a good time to rely on Jesus. It's a good time to remember who's in control of everything. Because otherwise it would be perhaps a time of, it would definitely be a time of worry and anxiety, but it might even be a time of despair.
No, certainly. Yeah, it seems like with Trump, and the thing that's really brought a lot of people up is the response to him, Kanye, you know, all the names, the racist and all these other things, and then normal people saying, well, actually, I kind of agree with him, and then they start getting called names, and, well, no, I'm not a Nazi. Why would you call me that? Doesn't matter. So it seems like right now the right, and when I say the right, I'm talking about your average person out there. They're being lumped in with everybody, and the left is showing themselves to who they really are. So we've got a common enemy. And as to what's going to happen, I don't really know. One fear that I have is that when an enemy is defeated, everybody goes home and thinks that everything's fine. So I'd certainly say it's necessary to have more of a basis for the movement than merely a temporary enemy. There's a larger one.
Absolutely. Yeah.
I think it does exhaust people, though, to have to keep fighting enemies to be eternally vigilant. Because, like, I felt like the alt-right, after Trump won, a lot of people just kind of said, all right, we got our guy in there now. Everything's good. So they kind of relaxed a bit. And then, like, people are got tired of, like, the fight just kind of wears you down over time.
Yeah.
So.
Well, the thing.
Yeah. Yeah.
Go ahead, Ian.
No, go ahead.
Well, the thing about the thing about white people who are really, you know, who haven't completely lost touch with our heritage, you know, with the way of life that sustained us and helped us to flourish and succeed and achieve great things for, you know, many centuries, they're again, you know, the wrath of the awakened Saxon, you know, they don't want to, I mean, I think this is kind of sort of, you know, what's going on in Sweden, although, you know, they're not really, clearly they're not very, they're not in touch with, you know, their traditional way of life, but, you know, I think we tend to kind of wait and, you know, hope and, you know, kind of, give people the benefit of the doubt and, you know, and then when it gets really bad, you know, you do get something like the Third Reich. You get you know, you get a very strong, a very organized, a very calculating, and generally throughout history, a successful reaction, you know, blowback. And and unfortunately, this is so frustrating to me, because I think a lot of us, traditionalists, reactionaries, alt-right, greater alt-right, we've amongst ourselves, we've been talking about this stuff for a while. And it's exasperating to know that while we're talking about it, the time to deal with these things in a way that doesn't involve, a lot of chaos and potential bloodshed, it's just slipping away. Did I break the hangout?
No. Sorry.
Was that too black of a pill?
Yeah. Just dropping them black pills. Sorry, that's my
deal. Yeah,
anyway, like I said, it's a good time. It's a good time to rely on Jesus. It's a good time. And going back to how we started, it's also a good time to network and get to know each other, and when that time comes, we'll have our community.
Yeah. Hey, Gray Rebel. I mentioned earlier the show we did where we discussed the South. And do you think that Christianity in the South is still as strong among just average people as it traditionally has been in past times?
Oh, well, I'm no expert on it in general. Like I said, I came up Independent Fundamental Baptist. I would say that it's not as strong in the outward form. The main problem that from talking to people that I've seen is a lot of hypocrisy on the part of churchgoers. You've got people that go to church and act all holy and then leave church and stab people in the back and lie and cheat and all these things. And then people, rightly don't want to have anything to do with that. What's the point of speaking holiness and then not living it?
Right.
So in that sense, I would say that's low, but in general, a lot of the morality, I would say that's still there.
Okay. Well, yeah, I mean, there will always be hypocrites in the church, I'm sure, people who go to church and don't always live up to it.
And thanks to wonderful televangelists like Joel Osteen and the people that run around healing people for money, that's when people hear church and Christianity, that's what they think, sadly.
I will put your name in my gold-bound Bible, and I will pray for you every day.
Yeah.
Back in North Carolina, there was this lady on TV. This, I guess she's a black woman preacher, used to say that. She used to have these like infomercial type TV segments, and where she'd like advertise all these products and stuff like that. I think a couple of, a while back, I found a website where they collected all the videos and saved them for posterity, and you could just watch them, and they're interesting. They're kind of funny too.
Yeah, but I used to do stuff like that, and it's yeah.
Yeah?
No, go ahead.
No, go. I wasn't really saying anything. Go ahead.
No, I was just I used to watch things, not specifically things exactly like that, but just bad things that come out of heretic groups, and I had to stop because it just really gets. It's just bad for you after a while if you indulge in it.
Oh yeah,
and unfortunately, that is the caricature that your typical SJW or just kind of normie liberal uses to as their point of reference from which, you know, any conversation about Christianity springs.
Yeah,
I mean, people do look at people like at televangelists as sort of a representative of the whole faith. I mean, I noticed, I was around in the 80s, but I was just a kid, so I wasn't really plugged into pop culture as much. But I started noticing that there were a lot of songs released in the late 80s that were critical of Christianity, like from different rock groups, heavy metal groups. Like, I know that I think Ozzy Osbourne had a song about Jimmy Swaggart, and there's some 80s hair bands where they mentioned people like I think there's a song called Shoot the Preacher Down by the Bullet Boys. Let's see, there was a Poison had Something to Believe In. Those were different songs that kind of seemed to take a skeptical or critical view of Christianity, or the idea that these people are hypocrites. So, and I feel like there were some others around that time too, but
well, and then, yeah, then I mean, there were all
the Jimmy Swaggart and Jim Baker stuff was going on.
And then there were all those songs where they were criticizing Islam. Yes, that's a joke. That's
okay.
Yeah, it's so easy to, you know, and again, they're like, as you pointed out, Ian, they were using that caricature. It's, you know, it's so easy to be edgy and irreverent, you know, to the people that at the worst are probably going to pray for you. You know, I mean, that's,
yeah.
So, welcome, Arbogast.
Yeah. Hey, Arbogast, haven't seen you in a while.
Yeah, no, but sorry. Schedule really hasn't allowed me to participate in these, but I have some free time unexpectedly this evening. So,
oh, cool.
Here I am.
Yeah, I thought you said you had to study or something tonight.
Yeah, well, I just got done doing that for the past couple hours, so I'm going to take a break.
Yeah, definitely do that. It's not good to...
Can you mention what you're studying without doxing yourself? If you can't, don't worry about it.
It's just like French. I mean, it's not like related to like anything specific I'm doing. No, it's fine.
Cool.
Yeah.
His avatar is holding down the fort for him, though.
I was thinking the same thing, William. It's like studying for you.
I don't need to study. My Abby studies for me.
That would be great if I could just do like a mind meld with my Abby for the exam. That would be fantastic, but alas, I did not have that capability.
Huh. I don't think you could take part in a Christian hangout if you had an avatar that, you know, could supernaturally, like some sort of weird golem, start acting on your behalf. And at least not that I know of. I don't know.
I don't know. You're right. That would just be, you know, yeah, that would be pretty antithetical to the purpose of this hangout.
It would be fun, though. It would be kind of cool.
It's a very ecumenical hangout, though, so I don't know.
Oh, okay.
That's true.
Do we have any like non-binary lesbian Jews, or is
oh, that not that ecumenical?
Oh, I'm sorry.
No,
we're working on that.
Sorry.
If a non-binary lesbian Jew wanted to join this hangout and claim to be a Christian, I'd probably say no.
That's just because you're a nativist xenophobe.
That's right.
Yep. I'll own it.
Judgmental hater.
Yep. I reject equality.
Amen.
So I guess that makes me a blasphemer in this day and age.
Well, that's kind of something I wanted to reply to Gray Rebel with, you know, the kind of the opposite, kind of the other side of the coin, I guess, to what you were saying, Gray Rebel, with, you know, televangelists and the kind of the, like the snake oil salesman, is like in my church, you know, there's the majority of the Catholic Church that, you know, they do the Novus Ordo Mass, and they're what, you know, kind of drove out people like me, you know, and thankfully we can still go to the Latin Mass, and you know, that's where the, you know, all of the people who are kind of medieval, like me go. But you know, the mainstream Catholic Church, they're, you know, they're not necessarily, you know, doing that sort of hypocritical thing, but they've been trying really hard to, you know, conform themselves to the world and to, you know, be accommodating and to, they've really embraced the pause, you know, to put it briefly. And, you know, it hasn't done them any good. You know, it's as we all know, you know, you, anything you give to the enemy does not endear you to them. You know, if anything, it makes them, you know, hold you in contempt. You know, so it's kind of the opposite, in a way, opposite side of that phenomenon that you were talking about.
Now, there's certainly, well, formerly Protestant denominations that have done the same thing to their detriment.
Yep.
And are doing, of course.
Yeah, it's a. I live in a pretty small New England town, and there's a church here that's from the 1600s, and you know, so it was a
mainline Protestant.
Yeah, I mean, it was presumably a Puritan church at first, at least, and today. You know, I think I mentioned this to you guys at the last hangout. But you know, I drive by it and there's a rainbow flag hanging on the front of it, you know, saying something, you know, something to the effect of, you know, God loves
you
all.
Everybody here.
Yeah, God loves you all, or you know, something like that. And that's, you know, it they're still going to use the caricature that we were talking about with the evangelists. Or, you know, the hateful Catholic who wants to, you know, string up all the gays and you know, deny women the right to breathe, whatever. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter how much you give. It doesn't matter how much you give to the world. It's, and you know, all you do is just alienate yourself from God.
Yeah. Is Norvus Ordo heretical?
No.
Yeah, no. That's what Louis is saying in the text chat.
No, I mean it's
saying that it's not necessarily.
No, I mean I would almost call it, this is a strong word, but I would almost call it abominable. You know, it's just. All of the reverence, you know, all of the focus on God down, you know, beginning with the orientation, you know, facing towards the Orient, you know, the priest facing away from the congregation, you know, because it's about God, you know, it's just really turned things around and made it a little bit, well, kind of a lot more about the people. That's my issue. You know, I was raised Catholic. I got older. I got into New Age mumbo jumbo, and I was an atheist for maybe a decade before I came back to the church. And you know, after a year or two, I just noticed the Novus Ordo was about the people. You know, the people were joking around. They weren't. There wasn't that respect. You know, when I go to Mass now, it's, you go in there and it's quiet except for, you know, babies and little kids, because people that go to the Latin Mass, they're normal people. They have a lot of kids. And it's all about God, and you never forget that. So it's not heretical, but I would argue that heretical things do come of it, because the more you chip away at, and we all know this, the more you chip away at hierarchy, the more room you allow people to, you know, sort of partake of the poisonous brew of egalitarianism. And you know, that not everyone, people need to be led. in other words. And I think that the Novus Ordo has really chipped away at that. It's I don't know. I don't miss it. Yeah. I don't miss it.
Ironically, it provides space for the First Church of what's happening now to happen, right? This is sort of an irony or a joke about Protestants sometimes made by Catholics.
Uh-huh.
But in fact, but there's two aspects to Novus Ordo. One is the changes to the liturgy itself, which is actually yes. true. Even the Latin, because even the Latin Mass as practiced now is a Novus Ordo Latin Mass. It's not.
Yes. Yep.
Not the it's not the Mass prior to, at least not typically prior to Vatican II.
Well, I mean, interject real quick, but I think wasn't the thing that Benedict XVI released. It had to do with the 1962 revision.
Did he actually reinstate a prior Mass?
I think, I have to look it up, but I'm pretty sure that it's the 1962 Missal.
Yeah, I'm actually holding it in my hand right now.
That's
the Missal we use.
What's prior to, it was Pope Paul who, sorry, we're getting all Catholic here. It was Pope Paul who changed the liturgy. It wasn't actually until the late 60s, early 70s.
Yeah. It was
the real Novus Ordo of changes came into place.
Well, I think between, like, because Pius the 12th instituted changes to the rites of Holy Week during the 1950s. I think from the mid-50s to the late 1960s until the Novus Ordo was finalized, there was like a series of progressive reforms, if I remember correctly, from what I've read. But
the important distinction, I think, is what William made, and I should have made it. There's the change in the liturgy, which isn't terribly radical, and the results. Now, you know, one of them.
A change in allowing a kind of a fluidity of form.
Yeah. I mean, it kind of opened things up, like I said, to the egalitarianism. Like, just one small example, you know, taking the Eucharist in your hands. Now, that wasn't explicitly allowed in Vatican II. I believe it started in Holland or Germany, like, you know, some kind of Marxist or, you know, liberation theology sort of probably the Jesuits. I can't remember. They decided to try that, and you know it wasn't really challenged. The Vatican has really just let things kind of run away with them. But William, you know, you also make a good point with when I've been to Mass in the Philippines, and it's the Novus Ordo Mass. You know, it's in their language. It's in Tagalog. There's some English in it, but you're right. I mean, it's very much like a Latin Mass in the sense that it's still a little bit more solemn. The people are still more prayerful. They're more reverent. But you know, Vatican II, it was essentially the church shooting itself in the foot. And I have no doubt that the church will recover. You know, we've been through this before. This is what prompted Martin Luther to nail his theses to the door. You know, I mean, we end up, it's the Church of God, but we end up with men running it, and we all know that you know, men are not infallible. So, yeah.
Yeah. Of course, I know that. I don't want to start any denominational disputes, but I know that different people would have different opinions on what the proper anchor is for judging the truth and judging the right way. I know that I was listening to E. Michael Jones and his opinion of why Protestantism doesn't work because he's Catholic, of course. And but you know, different Protestants I've talked to said that, well, the advantage to Protestantism is that if the church structure goes the wrong way, we can still return to scriptures and say, no, you're doing it wrong.
Well, I think we all agree on the importance, and this is why I really appreciate these hangouts with you guys, and I respect you. I think we do agree that a reasonably, you know, solid hierarchy is a good thing, you know, when it comes to theological matters.
Yeah, actually, I was just making the comment too that, you know, you have all of us who are, you know, I guess reactionaries of some sort. I mean, we all know Ian. But with that, I mean, there's a good chance that we have more in common with each other than the most liberal parts of our respective denominations.
Yes. And not only that, just, you know, the as Gray Rebel was saying earlier, you know the kind of people that you were talking about, Gray Rebel, they're what we call we Catholics call them, you know, cafeteria Catholics, and you know, the politicians, we call them limousine Catholics, and
Joe Biden.
Yeah, yep, Nancy Pelosi.
Yes.
You know, I mean, that we have nothing in common with them. You know, it's one thing I will say regarding hypocrisy. This is something that a good pastor for a traditional Catholic mass will occasionally point out, that we need to be careful, you know, not to be hypocritical, not to be pharisaical, you know, because it's tempting, you know, to look at yourself and say, you know, hey, I'm celebrating the mass the way it was celebrated 700 years ago, and you know, I'm doing everything, you know, I pray the rosary every day, I'm doing everything I can to resist this, you know, degenerate culture, and look at all these other people. And you know, it's kind of the, you know, don't forget the mote. I mean, don't forget the beam in your eye.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
One thing about it, though, is I mentioned to William before we got started that I recently had a conversation with Todd Lewis of Christian Hangout Number 4 fame, and like I said, I don't necessarily agree with everything he says, because some of what he says I can't necessarily refute, but I quite ring true to me, some of the things he says, but he doesn't have a very high opinion of Catholics, I guess, because he's an Anabaptist. And we were talking about how there does seem to be kind of, it's interesting that, well, we've talked about it on some of these hangouts before, but many of the more, I guess you could say, the older denominations, like the Catholics, like they tend to be very liberal in many ways, even though, and many reactionaries would say that Protestantism is a form of liberalizing Christianity, but it does seem that Protestants tend to be the most conservative Christians in most places. Like, even Gregory has mentioned that the reason he's a Baptist in an Orthodox country is because they're the most conservative. I mean, what do you guys think of that? Do you think that, how would you explain that? Anybody?
I mean, in some ways, like, I know for this country, you know, it's the disease of Americanism. A good example, I know you guys were talking about limousine Catholics. There's a joke I've heard is that, you know, what do you call the Democratic Party at prayer? It's the Greek Orthodox Archdiocese. you know, so you have certain groups, I think, within every denomination that, for better or worse, become the face of it. Well, really, for worse, they become the face of it, that have bought in to the American system. You know, I can easily see how someone could say that, you know, if you look at what goes on in certain Catholic churches, certain Orthodox churches, even with the, you know, High Church Episcopalians, you could certainly find a lot to be disgusted there, a lot that's revolting. And, you know, you may have that sort of, you know, kicking the other direction to go to something like being a Baptist or something like that. But you know, who was that you mentioned before who's a Baptist in Orthodox country?
Gregory Carlin. He's the guy who's been on some of our hangouts. I don't know if you know him.
What country is he live in?
Romania.
Oh, I think I was on one of the ones with him.
Okay. Yeah, I can't remember. I know you've only been on like three.
Yeah, you were. I was at that one.
Yeah, that's
you,
right.
You might
yeah.
not have noticed him. He's very quiet.
No, I I know. Oh, I know what you're talking about now.
Very measured in his tone and
that's
and,
right.
and language. Yeah.
I think never we need to kill all the homosexuals.
I mean, I can't speak to the situation of the church in Romania. I really know nothing about it. But I guess in America, that's actually the one benefit because, you know, in some ways you don't have to deal with like a national church structure, that's really the only option. But, yeah, I don't know. I guess that's my take on it. So,
what do you think, Gray Rebel? Do you have any thoughts on that? About whether Protestantism tends more toward conservatism, or if that's true, or why?
I couldn't really say if it's Protestantism in general, because I haven't really looked at Catholicism or Orthodoxy. I've spent most of my or all of my life in Protestantism of sorts. Really seems like the groups that stay conservative longer are those that are kind of, for better or worse, detached from, like you were saying, the Americanism. Even if they do fly the American flag and say the pledge and all the, or not all the services, but in the, they have the patriotic service, they're still kind of backwoods-ish. They've got more of a little bit more of a tie to their roots than the broader culture. And I don't know if that's because of religion or because of their culture. So not too much insight there, I'm afraid.
Well, it's okay. Go on.
Well, my view of this, and I'm not going to speak for, you know, my Protestant friends, but in general, I think, and you could even say this about Muslims, it's a pretty simple thing. The farther away you get from God and striving to live a godly life. You know, like I, once a month, or unfortunately in the last year when I've been pretty ill, you know, less than that, but I pick up The Imitation of Christ by Thomas A. Kempis. And you look at that, and this is a book. I mean, he was a Catholic monk, but a lot of Protestants and Lutherans, and they admire him. He was so humble and so focused on trying, I mean, you know, just the title of the book, The Imitation of Christ. So those are the people, whatever, and I understand, Ian, that you're talking in a general sense, you know, does this, you know, denomination tend more towards a traditional worldview? It's, I guess, and I can imagine, you know, where Gray Rebel comes from, where they're seems to be more of a traditional, which I guess these days we would call conservative outlook, even among people who aren't terribly religious. But you know, just like I've told you guys, joking around, but it's the truth. You know, where I go to church, the people I hang out with, they're really nice people. They're really good people. They're humble, but I can genuinely imagine any of us being okay living in, you know, 16th century Spain. You know, I mean, you know, obviously with a few adjustments, you know, we'd all have to buy our pantaloons and, you know, learn Spanish, but, that was my attempt at humor, but it's sticking, Yeah.
Oh, I was muted.
That was very charitable with you. But it's a matter of have you discovered? You know, have you discovered the joy? Have you discovered the fulfillment of living in Christ to your utmost ability? And those are the people who, you know, viewed from the outside, they're going to be seen as, like, you know, anything from conservative to anachronistic to hateful, whatever. But those are, and I don't know if any particular denomination has more of a claim on those sorts of people. But what I do imagine, and I was thinking of this a little bit when William was talking about his daughter attending Mass, and I see this with younger guys in their 20s that are reactionaries, because I'm in my 40s. I wonder if, you know, because I remember growing up, there was a sense among people my age, Generation X, that something was off, you know, something's wrong. This isn't right. You know, just our instincts were telling us something was wrong. But now, you know, with the current generation, it seems they're a little bit more inclined to pursue that and find the truth and find something more purposeful and meaningful in religion. So I don't know. I kind of led this simple conversation down a serpentine, but dimly lit hallway. But I don't know. I think it's the closer you get to God and living as Christ told us to, you know, living the kingdom of God. You know, are you repenting? Are you repenting for your sins? Are you trying to love God with all your being? Are you trying to love your neighbor as you love yourself? Then those are the people that are going to seem more conservative. And I'm blessed enough to have found a pretty decent group. You know, where I go to Mass, it's gotten bigger. It's gotten considerably bigger. And I think part of that is a function of how degenerate and how nihilistic our society has gotten. Sorry to ramble on.
No, you saying that reminded me of something you said earlier, brought a thought to my mind, is that, well, thought that I had is, we as creatures of God, God made us to worship Him, and when we cease worshiping Him, worship is a function that something we have to do. And so when we don't worship God, we have to worship something else. And then when you were saying just now, it brought to mind that something that Cambry Will Not Yield always points out, and that, you know, worshiping the Christ we've learned through our, I think he puts it, our racial hearth fire, and exchanging it for something, this concoction of the mind, or I forget the exact wording, but yeah, when we replace one, we have to worship something else.
Yep.
Yeah.
And it's even like, I mean, you look at just your average liberal. It's like, you know, they have, it's kind of just a joke, but it's in a way there's some truth to it. You know, it's like they'll have a, you know, religious devotion to something like global warming or migrant crisis or something. You know, there's the you're absolutely right. You know, the urge towards transcendence, the urge to dedicate oneself to something, you know, it's a shame to forsake, you know, the sacrifice made on Calvary, you know, which was the perfect sacrifice. It's the perfect thing to direct that instinct to. And it's a shame how far it's gotten, you know, and the turnaround, you know, away from that.
No, I just noticed this now, Lumen, but your avatar looks like it says "Let's."
Yeah, it actually does. I mean, it's the ET, the Latin,
yeah,
which is where the ampersand symbol
yeah
comes from,
right?
I'm kind of big on I made that avatar.
Yeah. I know. I never noticed that it spelled let until now. I always thought LLS, but I never noticed that you could say let.
It's my subtle way of, you know, inviting people to come on. Let's luminate salt. Let's light and salt all together now.
Yeah, works.
And we'll pull out the bongos and the tambourine and the acoustic guitar and kumbaya.
Gonna get all Novus Ordo on it.
Exactly. I told Ian not this past week, but the one before that, when I went to Mass to go, because there's a confession service afterwards, and that's what I really wanted to do. So I went to Mass, and I didn't take the Eucharist, but it was Palm Sunday, and it was Novus Ordo, and it's almost like God's little joke with me. Like I'm taking, you know, creative liberty with this story, but you know, it's almost like, you know, nudging me like, yep, here you go. This is what happens when you go to Novus Ordo. There's the acoustic guitar. There's the tambourine. it's just stuff like that at the Novus Ordo. You know, I had a colleague years ago, and I'll spare you guys the vulgar language, because he's not a Christian, and you know, we were talking about Catholicism, and he, you know, he was asking me about the Latin Mass, and I was telling him, and that's what he said. He's like, you mean they don't have the, you know, the hippies playing the acoustic guitars and the bongos, and I was like, no, you know, it's either, you know, a baritone, you know, intoning the Mass, or, you know, maybe the organ. And that's what he said. He's like, that's what I imagine, you know, worshiping God should be. It should be effing mysterious.
Lee says they should have electric guitars at the Mass.
Wow.
It'd be like a...
Like Woodstock or something.
Or it could be like a Zodiac Mind Warp video. Yeah, that's he has a video that's semi-blasphemous, but I think it's because the song is called Prime Mover. So, and somebody look at the YouTube video of it in the comments section, somebody said, I don't think this is what Thomas Aquinas had in mind.
I'm looking at the chat here, Imperial Aspirations, guitars and churches is justification enough to have another Inquisition, to be honest. I agree. You know, like, let's have a real one this time, you know, like the one that, you know, we're always accused of having, you know,
do it right.
Yep. Yeah. Root and branch this time.
Do it. Yeah. That would be fun.
But going back to, you know, who, you know, which, you know, where will you find the most, you know, the most pervasive tendency towards a traditionalist outlook? I kind of look at what we do with these hangouts as somewhat of a, I don't know if microcosm is the right word, but just sort of almost a precursor, because if things get really bad here in the West, which I'm using the word very liberally, because it's, you know, it's, things will probably get bad. You know, it's guys like us, people like us, our families, we're going to need to rely on each other. And it's the, you know, from the different, obviously there are some denominations that are just so far gone that, you know, that I don't know. I mean, they're not going to have much to offer, but you know, all of us, you know, we're going to need to pull together, and you know, it's not like we're going to be uniting necessarily under, you know, a unified banner, you know, the ecumenical traditionalist fraternity, whatever. But it's going to be up to us, you know, as far as the Christian contingent goes, and who knows, you know, by that time maybe in, you know, Christianity will have taken the same path as, you know, kind of like the alt-light and your average, you know, I'm a Constitution patriot. You know, like maybe we'll all be viewed as, you know, Nazi Christians at that point. We'll all be lumped together. I don't know.
Now, I've had conversations with other people about, you know, forming networks and stuff like that, too. I mean, that's really what it's going to be. I think someone posted on Twitter about having a, like, a league of far-right attorneys to support one another in case of legal trouble. I forget who it was that they said they could name it after. You guys can probably find the tweet, but yeah. I mean, it's something that we're going to have to do, you know, in the future, because it's certainly, you know, they're not going to do us any favors. And unless in society entirely collapses, you know, well, then we'll really need to rely on one another. But
I thought I heard that they did have something sort of like that. There's some sort of attorney group, like, might have something to do with freedom in their name, but I think they, it's like they are committed to fighting for the unpopular right-wing opinions.
Who is Spencer's lawyer with the Auburn thing?
I don't know, but I mean, it might have been related to that same group.
Mm.
I was actually just watching Spencer's Auburn speech, like, before this hangout, because I hadn't actually watched it yet. It was interesting. I didn't get to watch the Q&A, though, but the speech itself was okay.
Mm-hmm.
He seemed a little nervous, like he's a little worn out from all that he's been through.
Mm-hmm.
So he didn't seem quite as cocksure as he normally is. But
have you seen the picture of him? Oh, where was it? Where he's trying to flip someone off?
It
just looks ridiculous in the process.
The goofy face.
Yes.
Yeah, I think I did.
Oh, that was great. Well, who do you think's what do you think's going to happen with speaking of people who are in trouble with the law? What do you think's going to happen with Andrew Anglin? Or I may be mispronouncing his last name.
You what's mean? You mean is it he's getting sued by the ADL or something?
Yeah, he's being sued by the ADL for targeting the woman who was trying to extort Richard Spencer's mother.
Right. I heard something about that.
Yeah.
Yeah, I saw on America.org there was a story about that, but they're saying that, like, this woman clearly did something illegal and she should be punished for it, so I don't know what, like, her situation is her fault, not because Anglin targeted her.
Well, it's going to be interesting what comes out. That's for sure.
Yeah. This whole situation we're in today where we even have to worry that, like, obvious justice won't be carried out by our courts or by our government or our system, whatever you want to call it. It's very mind-boggling because I guess I'm still used to growing up with the general feeling that, you know, clearly we'll you know, the law will take care of things and that the people involved will be honest, but now I'm not so sure. I used to take that for granted, though, that it would be.
Well, you saw the one, I think the one person, I think the first person deported who was like a dreamer, he's going
through
the court of that one guy who supports La Raza.
Hmm.
Yeah, really.
I mean, that
sounds like a conflict of interest.
Well, yeah, I mean, he absolutely should recuse himself, but you know he's not going to. But
yeah. But wait, so what's the situation exactly? Has he been deported, or has he to go through the courts first?
Are the
guys the judge?
Know the specifics. I heard it was going through that judge. I don't know why. It was just a tweet I saw.
Oh. Yeah, I didn't. I saw a headline about it, but I didn't really look into the details of it.
Yeah.
It It's funny how headlines can really shape our view of what's going on, because most people just look at the headline, they don't read the article.
Yeah, they're always...
I guess we're all guilty of that to some degree.
Yeah.
Of course, then you get clickbait, where we'll just put out a really stupid title, and you think something's going on, which isn't... I really hate clickbait.
And they should make alt-right clickbait. I mean, they have the alt-right fan fiction account.
Well, there was that site, Ovenworthy, that TRS used to run, which was like a alt-right... It's like a parody of clickbait sites, basically. It was really funny, but I guess they kind of got bored with it after a few months and just shut it down. That was pretty funny while it lasted, though.
So I don't think I ever checked that out. Hmm.
Yeah, well, it was like they'd like post like YouTube videos and add some like clickbait type commentary to it, like, this is amazing, and like, check out this whatever, you know, that kind of stuff. Or like I remember they went one that was really funny is they posted a video of the Black Hebrew Israelites and arguing with this Jewish guy on the street, and he starts crying and I know I feel bad for laughing at that, but it was actually pretty funny. And they had some headline like, you know, check out these great Black people like fighting this racist white guy or something like that. And it's meant to be the type of thing that would grab your attention. Then if you actually watch it, you'd see it's kind of the opposite of what you'd expect.
Funny enough, I was just scrolling through Occidental Descent looking for anything on this England deal, and from the 17th, Michael Cushman's article, 10 ideas for a free Dixie, number 8 will shock you.
Oh, yeah. That's sweet.
That's great.
What is number 8?
Well,
Rahoa.
It's too shocking. You're going to have to look at it yourself.
Yeah, I don't know that it's...
Spencer put a video on YouTube for, you know, for his altright.com channel last week, and it was something like, try these two weird tricks to solve the North Korea crisis.
Yeah.
And this is something that kind of, I mean, it's not really related to religion, but this is something that kind of occurred to me about the success of the alt-right, and especially with our memes, and why the left ends up just needing to send, you know, Antifa into the streets, is because humor requires one of the essential ingredients in humor is truth. And you know, for the left, they have to either acknowledge the truth, which is it's the antithesis of everything they believe, or they just can't do it. I mean, they can't have anything humorous, you know. So it's kind of in average people, you know, the people who are alt-light are people who are just your average, you know, everyday, working stiff. You know, they're going to gravitate to that. They're going to gravitate to you know, someone that, I mean, as long as you don't push it too far, like, you know, celebrating Hitler's birthday or something, you know. Sorry, I did it again. But that's just, what do you guys think of that? I mean, it's like, you know, acknowledging the truth about whatever, about race, about the JQ. I mean, this is what I think, this is one of the, what makes our humor and therefore our outreach, you know, a little bit more genuine and successful.
I think actually, you know, what you're seeing now is you kind of saw, the alt-right kind of push the envelope with a lot of this. And now you see maybe people, I guess, who aren't viewed as extreme. You know, like, for instance, I don't know if you saw with Lauren Southern, she posted that fake Occupy Democrats meme where it was praising Nathan Domingo.
Yes.
For punching that bitch because she had appropriated dreadlocks. I mean, I just don't think you would have seen that 2 years ago.
And she, I mean, she's hardly like, you know, 1488 material.
Yeah. But I think definitely we've pushed the envelope. I think we're continuing to push it. And as kind of we've sort of cleared space with, you know, our humor and such, people are, you know, are falling behind. I think we've kind of successfully pushed, you know, the Overton window of humor to the right. So
even like the show that you work on, Grey Rebel, you know, like I've only listened to maybe two full episodes. There are so many podcasts out there right now that I kind of wish I could listen to, but just that, you know, you're listening to this, you know, kind of homespun, really wholesome and, churning butter kind of, having a picnic after church, and some of the humor that they come up with, you know, it's just these are, and that's just, you know, that's just one variant, you know, it's different obviously from the Daily Showa. And it's really nice. It's really nice to see, you know, because it does seem to be working.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think the Good Morning White America is definitely a very encouraging program.
It is.
I listen to it just about every week, unless I'm like super busy.
You should never be too busy to listen. That's just how it is.
You kind of walked into that one, Ian.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, I mean, like those two, they're just good. Those are the kind of people that. Except they're not Catholic, and you know we can't all be perfect. Hey-o! Just kidding.
I'm fucking white.
Those are the kind of people that I'm talking about when I am talking about the people that I see after Mass. They're just normal people. They're just, you know, just decent people who are trying to raise their kids right. You know, trying to make a good home, trying to set a good example for their kids. Trying to be there for their community, you know, those are, again, you know, these are the people who haven't lost touch with the way of life that is not only has not only achieved a lot for Europeans, but was just really, you know, it's just consonant with the European soul. It's just who we are, and it's a pity to. You know, it's perhaps, you know, more tragic than the prospect of being dispossessed of our lands is how before that happens, you know, being dispossessed of our soul, you know, and I don't say that necessarily in the religious sense, although, you know, it is part of it, but I mean, just dispossessed of, the attributes of people like that, you know, like the, just your average, white family. It's sad.
Yeah. Seems like we lost a lot of viewers. You're up to like 23 at one time. Now we're down to 9. What happened to all you guys? Are we boring you? Tell us where.
I'll take the blame.
No, we were told that we were having the best podcast yet.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. Ian, this is a very, this is a very white bread cast we have. Maybe that's why we're not diverse or enriching enough for your audience.
I'm kind of off white. It's the French. I think that I'm Celtic and German, but there's a little French, so I think, you know, slightly, you know, sort of towards ecru or cream, whatever.
You Gaelic weirdo.
This is fighting words, lad.
We need to spice up. We need drama, an argument of some sort.
I think people are begging Louie to join. Actually, Delta, who was with us last time, according to his Twitter profile, he's a mulatto. I don't know if that's a joke or if he's serious, but he said he wants to join tonight.
There's your diversity.
Yeah. See, we're not all hardcore racialists here. We just believe it's something, but it's not the only thing.
We save the Rahoa for after hours.
Yeah.
We're weekend Rahoa warriors.
But seriously, folks, we're just joking here.
Or are we?
Look, I don't want to get this YouTube channel showed, so yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, now the...
I want to make sure people know this is a joke. Anyway, go on, Greg Rebel.
From the very beginning, we were talking about anti-fa and just be fa. Could your slogan be Semper Fa?
Ooh.
Semper Fa.
Nice.
I was thinking you had asked a question earlier, and I never chimed in. Sorry, I'm a bit snotty today. The question about Protestants and whether they're more inclined, and I guess more like the bigger kind of question that you get this kind of criticism, not just by Catholics, but by there's this reactionaries in general where they say, you know, that the Reformation was one of the things that led us to radical individualism and
cracking the hierarchy a little bit.
Yeah, leading. I mean, and you will even hear this narrative spoken in. Like in the universities, that when they talk from a Eurocentric kind of, ironically Eurocentric kind of viewpoint, they'll say, "Well, we did this, and then we had the Reformation, and then we had the Enlightenment." Right? So their narrative is that it's all about, the Protestantism was an essential element to the destruction of Christianity. And I'm not trying to say anything one way or the other, but when we're looking at Protestantism, it does have that, I suppose it does have that capacity, but it also in a sense has a quicker capacity to reform,
according to the word of God,
but to restore, because when the authoritarian churches pause, the pause is usually entrenched, right? Deeply entrenched in the
bishops and stuff.
Yeah, like the idea, there was a Episcopalian bishop who said, we need a gay bishop, because as soon as we have it, the condition on the ground, I might have said this here before, as soon as we have that condition on the ground, there's nothing really that can be said about it. And there is truth in that, because as soon as that bishop has confirmed or baptized or whatever, as soon as that bishop has done things, if you're going to then, in half a generation, say that bishop is invalid, now you're invalidating things that have happened in the church. So Protestantism is in a sense lighter on its feet and easier, able to respond in some. Just a comment. Sorry, is that Lu Yi that's joined us?
Yeah.
Chinese person defend Protestant.
China, yeah, that's right.
If they're not women and the validity of their orders isn't in question, of getting rid of the bad bishop and stuff.
Oh, Mark Citadel, hey.
Hey, Mark.
Hi, Mark.
Hey, Mark. Yeah, that's true. That's true. What you said there. I mean, yeah, because it's only a sin that they're doing.
Right.
Other than the idea that they're doing it as if it were, I guess they were also trying to combine the sanctifying gay marriages was also an aspect of that, because as soon as you have marriages or relationships, pretending to bless them as marriages, that now you've got condition on the ground. Now you've got trouble that's harder to deal with. Anyway,
can you hear us, Mark?
Yeah, yeah. I can hear you. I think I got it fixed.
Just thought I'd drop in. That's good to see you.
Yeah, I've been up late doing work, but I thought, you know, I just remembered that you had the hangout on tonight, so I thought I'd drop in quickly. How you doing?
Doing all right.
That's good too.
We have 9 viewers. Let's see if that goes up now that you're here.
You're doing all right.
We had we lost half our viewers in like 1 hour, so.
Oh, and you're worrying too much about.
I think that's the hour I joined.
That's when I started talking more.
The hour you perceived.
I think we could probably all point to something we did that could be the cause of this.
Well, I couldn't.
Except for Mark. Yeah.
Now you weren't here earlier. That was it.
That's right. They've been waiting for him all night.
Yep. Finally.
All right. See, you can be the one. So I guess it does open up a bigger question about modernity, and in a way, how I mean, I've been thinking about this a lot lately about how, I mean, we all suffer in this kind of age of where the fundamental ontological conception is that is randomness and accident, and that in a sense all of us kind of live in that world, those of us who have accepted certain aspects of contemporary or modern and contemporary cosmology and modern and contemporary biology. We're all sort of living in a world of accident, but we're trying to, you know, wrestle for bits and pieces of God in that, in a way that in the past, prior to the Enlightenment, prior to Copernicus, prior to these things, we would have just, you know, the world was a made place and God was the maker of the place. Whereas now it's like, well, it appears like it's an accident, but we still believe God did it. It's a fundamentally challenging aspect of our faith. And it's what does allow for a lot of pause, because essentially you get, and I see, you know, I've seen that, I do actually even in my church see it starting to wane, that the constantly doubtful homilies of the 90s have given way to faithful preaching, which is good. It's very heartening. But we are always, everybody's just a little bit kind of like the rug just might get pulled out from underneath them again. And this is a constant problem in modernity. I don't have an answer for it. I'm just putting it out there. And this is all kind of part of the uncertainty. We were talking about Protestantism before, but the Catholic Church through Vatican II pretty much went through a kind of Protestantizing process, in that it opened things up for
in Judaizing.
Sorry?
It was also a Judaizing influence as well.
Oh, yeah.
In Vatican II. If not explicitly, then certainly implicitly.
Yeah, I think there were explicit statements on.
Yeah, you're right. I'm trying to protect the channel.
apologizing, wasn't it? It was sort of like maybe that wasn't tied to Vatican II. It was around the same time, wasn't it?
I think that was
it?
John Paul II who tried to affirm the old covenant for the Jews, and then apologized for the great Shoah.
Oh, for crying out loud. Yeah, it's, you know. Ugh.
A quick question about Vatican II. Hold on. I had a quick question about Vatican II. Somebody said recently that in Vatican II, non-Catholics were allowed to vote on certain movements. Does anybody know if that's true?
I would doubt it. I heard that. I think they were observers. It was the first time that you had a convening of the
college.
The College of Catholics. That's what I'm looking for. That had observers from non-Catholic religions. I think they had Protestants. I don't know if there were Jews there. I think.
Oh, there were some who were officially Catholics, but they were Jews.
Oh well, yeah, you know, you always have that.
I can't speak on it with authority, and I probably should be able to a little bit more so since I'm Catholic. But I have a dear friend who's a monk, and a Benedictine monk, and you know he was telling me that, you know, a good 82 to 85% of Vatican II is perfectly Orthodox, and it's just the small amount that has just really, and it's what the Pope later, you know, rightly called, you know, the small crack. You know, at first it was the crack that was supposed to let the sun in, but he admitted that it allowed the smoke of Satan to come in. You know, so it's just these it's just had these unintended or intended, either way, consequences that have, as I said earlier, you know, have amounted to the church shooting itself in the foot. I mean, look at attendance, look at the enrollment in, you know, for religious orders. It's clear. It's and we ignore it, you know, the same way that we ignore, you know, the effects of the civil rights movement and the war on poverty, etc.
Mm. Yeah, I'd love to have a little bit of time to read Marcel Lefebvre's, what's it called? I think it's called A Letter to Concerned Catholics, which is, I think, where he addresses this whole stuff about Vatican II and really sort of lays it out.
He's a hero.
Yeah, he's dead now, isn't he?
Yes.
When did he die? Is that in the 2000s? Marcel Lefebvre.
He started the Society of St. Pius X, which was up until Pope Benedict in schism with the church. There's now a tentative peace that's been reached. But I want to say maybe 2005, Mark. I can't remember for sure.
I thought it was in the 90s.
Yeah, that sounds about right.
What's that, Arbogast?
I thought it was in the 90s that he died, but I could be wrong.
You could be right. I don't know.
Yeah, I need to read so much more.
I just wanted to say I see we've been joined by Clement Pulaski. Hello, Clement. Can you hear us?
Yes, I can hear you. Thanks for having me on.
Hey, good to have you. We've got a Gray Rebel here too, so it's two GMWA representatives.
All right.
What's GMWA?
Would you like to introduce yourself?
Sure.
Good morning, White America.
Ah, yes, right.
GMWA is Good Morning, White America.
Hold on, sorry. I think can you hear us talking, Clement? I didn't mean to talk over you there.
No, yeah, I can hear you. Just with that many people on there, I'm sure it happens. But Good Morning, White America, of course, is the podcast run by Adam and Mary Gray, and we are also doing small group Bible studies online through Google Hangouts. I don't know how much of this you've explained already, Ian, but Ian's involved with that too.
We talked about it a little bit.
Okay, great. Well, I don't want to.
Would you like to tell us about what your background is with Christianity, specifically, like denominationally,
sure.
And all that?
Yeah. So I'm an evangelical Christian. When it comes to denominational distinctives like style of worship and understanding of the sacraments, I'm more on the Anglican side of things, but definitely evangelical Anglican. And sorry, did someone ask a question there?
Are you saying something, Louie?
Anglican represent.
Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah, Louis Anglican too.
As well here, yes.
Okay, excellent. Yeah, so as I said, on the evangelical side of things, both the biblical inerrancy and I guess really what I appreciate about Anglicanism is that it's Reformed and Catholic. That is, it's not just wanting to get rid of everything traditional that can't be demonstrated directly from the scriptures, but there's a lot of respect for church tradition, but at the same time understanding that churches can err even in matters of doctrine, and that reform is necessary from time to time.
Yeah, so it kind of kind of see things as it accounts for human error, then that's good.
Right. Yeah, exactly. But I didn't know if you want... I'm sorry?
Go on. No, go on.
I didn't want to interrupt whatever you guys were talking about there, or if you want to talk more about Good Morning White America and what we're doing there. Of course.
Yeah, we've talked about that a little. I mean, we had Hans and Anna Gigax on to sort of, I guess, promote it one time. So hopefully our listeners, if you want to say anything else about it, go ahead.
Clement, what do you do? I've only listened to the show like twice, but and I think it's great. But what do you do on the show? Are you a participant in the panel?
On Good Morning White America?
Yes.
In the podcast itself?
Yeah, I haven't been on the podcast. So another thing we've started to do is to produce basically sermon-type messages. And we try to get one out once a week, although we have off week sometimes. But on Fridays, we'll post scripture lessons between 20 and 40 minutes long. So I've done a couple of those so far.
Yeah, I listened to those. Those are good.
Definitely so right check now, those out, people. I just started a series on the Book of Proverbs, going through Proverbs and how it applies to our situation today.
But yeah, really Proverbs. Go on.
I was going to say, really what we're trying to do with Good Morning White America, with the ministry there, is offer people a church experience that they're not going to be able to get with the mainstream churches, which have been so taken over by modern philosophies and Zionism and multiculturalism and so forth. So there are the small group Bible studies where we have fellowship and prayer and study the word together. And then we also are producing the weekly audio messages. So if people want to hear a sermon from a perspective, a traditional Protestant perspective, they have that available to them as well. And of course, we hope and pray that this is just the first step in building a real reform movement within Protestant Christianity in the United States and throughout the West, to get people meeting in person throughout the country and building up real live congregations that are separate from the compromised mainstream churches.
Yeah. I think all of us would be in favor of something like that, although maybe some people would differ about the Protestant part, but we won't. But we can stand. Yeah. We stand together as Christians for things like this. So, what were we talking about before that? Did anybody have anything further to say on? Were we talking about Vatican II or SSTX or? Can't remember.
You had asked a question about Vatican II, but I didn't know.
And we were talking about the observers there.
Yeah, but I think that was. Yeah, I thought that.
Yeah. Hey, Clement, was it in the hangout on Sunday where somebody mentioned where we talked about Vatican II very briefly?
I don't remember that, although I guess I did have a question for, I'm assuming there are a few traditional Catholics on the line here.
And Illuminated. As I said,
maybe you've covered this before, but what you guys think about Bishop Williamson and his sort of breakaway group that he's forming now, I guess mainly in Brazil. Of course,
this is in Brazil, he said.
Yes.
I'm ashamed to say I don't know about it yet. You missed the earlier part of the show where I've been extremely sick this last year, and I actually, sadly, was away from Mass for a while. I've just been recovering the last couple of months, and I got to Mass on Easter. But this is the first time hearing of this.
Yes, of course. Bishop Williamson, I believe he was part of the Society of St. Pius. And
yeah, we were just talking about SSPX. Yeah,
he was.
And then he was kicked out because of his Holocaust revisionism.
Okay, yep, I have heard of him.
And now I read a news story a little while back where he is starting his own sort of breakaway from the breakaway group, where he's actually ordained another, or I should say consecrated another bishop at a monastery in Brazil. And they're trying to grow grow that way. And, you know, so for me as a Protestant, my view is that the church is corrupt. So we as believers covenanted together have the duty and ability to start new congregations. I know, of course, from the Catholic perspective, that's not a shared opinion. So I was just curious what you guys thought about ways of performing the church in these semi-schismatic or fully schismatic groups, and what status you think they have.
Can I just say something on this quickly before you jump in, Lumen? I listened not that long ago to a speech that Williamson had given at the London Forum. Is it available on YouTube? I'd encourage people to go and listen to it. He is actually he's quite interesting to listen to. I think he's a good speaker. But he had mentioned this. He'd mentioned that he had basically broken off from SSPX. I think this was around the time when it came back into communion with Rome. And yes, although the stuff regarding the Holocaust definitely had something to do with it, he basically had said that he had basically said that the coming back into communion with Rome was in fact a betrayal of SSPX's sort of stance, particularly on the fact that sort of Vatican II had remained as it was. I mean, you know, nothing was really given to SSPX in regard to their original sort of wishes. I do believe we are unsure about Marcel Lefebvre's death, what date it occurred on, but I think it occurred before that reconciliation took place, and I think Williamson was saying how the new leader of SSPX, who I don't know the name of, had basically betrayed Lefebvre's cause, and thus giving him impetus to go and make his own group. And it's all very, I mean, I'm Orthodox, just to let you know, it's all very sort of murky, because the priests, even if they are not in communion with Rome, they're not allowed to consecrate new bishops, but it's not as if they're stripped of their powers. There are actually certain priestly powers, as I understand it, that you can't take away from them once they've been consecrated. So even when SSPX was not in communion with Rome, it could still give out certain valid sacraments, as far as I understand it, because the church actually didn't have the power to take those away from the priests once they had been fully made a priest. You can't actually take it away from them.
Yes, that's true.
So I would assume this is, again, the sort of authority that Williamson believes himself to be operating under. And he is a I don't know his history. I don't know if he was consecrated by Lefebvre, or if he was originally like a full Catholic priest and then joined Lefebvre's. I don't know enough of his history to comment on that. But it is very interesting. I, again, don't know much about this Brazilian project yet.
They are in schism. And from what I understand, you know, you can, I was saying earlier, I was trying to go to the Easter Vigil Mass at a SSPX chapel, because I'd like to go, you know, I every time I go to Mass, I would much rather have it be the extraordinary form.
In Latin.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Which is sad, and, you know, I just called it the extraordinary form, which is kind of sad that it's, you know, but anyway.
That it's extraordinary.
Yeah, I mean.
But it isn't just ordinary.
Yeah, it's just normal. From what I understand, you can receive the sacrament of reconciliation, communion, but it's advised that you don't make a habit of essentially entrusting the salvation of your soul, you know, to any of these parishes. Now, for me, again, it's everyone I go to Mass with, you know, it's like a broken record every week after Mass, you know, we talk about how paused the Catholic Church is, you know, we're all Catholic. And Clement is right. You know, there's good priests will tell you, you know, the the church will be saved, and the saints have said this, you know, throughout the ages, that the church will be saved by the laity. And that's not to impart too much undue credit or power or holiness, whatever, to the laity, but it's what I see, you know, week after week, and we're still worshiping the way the church has been worshiping for several centuries. But yes, I mean, things will need, there will need to be an upheaval, and it's so corrupt. It's so corrupt in Rome right now, and it's sick. It's so sad, because this is, if you're a faithful Catholic, you look at the church as the bride of Christ. You know, it should be inviolable. You know, if you think of your own wife, you know, if you're a good man, if you're a good Christian, your wife should be inviolable. And you know, so it's very sad, but we're doing the best we can, and we're doing everything we can to adhere to Scripture. You know, to remember that Christ promised us he'd be with us to the end of time. You know, wherever two or more of us gather, he'll be there with us, and it's the best we can do right now. You know, it's to pray.
Do you listen to Charles Colomb at all? Colomb?
Occasionally, I do.
Yeah, he's quite interesting. He's not extreme enough for me, but I enjoy listening to his videos now and again. I think he's got some interesting insights.
He's almost Chestertonian a bit, you know, like in a modern.
Yeah, yeah. I think that's a valid description of him. I think it's interesting. I mean, it'd be interesting to meet him. Like I say, I don't think he really understands the racial
issue
fully. I think he's kind of shying away from it because of the obvious reasons. You know, but on a lot of other points, he does get it. I mean, he's a monarchist, so that's always a big tick in the box for me.
Yeah, I mean, go ahead, Luigi.
I don't know, not every monarchist is a...
So it's kind of hard to hear what you're saying, Louis. What are you saying?
Some monarchists just like the pageantry and the stuff, and I wouldn't.
I don't call those people monarchists, really. I call those people tchotchke collectors. You know, like, okay. I've got a teapot with Princess Diana's face on.
Well, no, I mean, some of them may even have some fetish for particular dynasties of Europe, and they're like, I miss the old dynasties. And
that's
not the point, though, right? Of having sacral kingship.
Well, you know, exactly. My great grandmother was one of these people. She absolutely loved she had a black and white TV. She, you know, had tape recordings of the coronation, and it's you know, I had no affinity for it back then. I thought it was all a bunch of baloney. But you know, then later on you realize exactly why you thought that way, because you realize that's not what it's actually about. That's not why monarchies exist. They don't exist for, you know, something nice to look at, and you know, figures. They're celebrities. They become essentially the equivalent of modern celebrities. But instantly, that's not what they're supposed to be at all.
They're SJWs.
Well, in many cases, yeah. I mean, I just view them as mainly pathetic now, especially in Western Europe. They, you know, there are worse ones than the British monarchy, of course, but they've all become pretty much a joke, and they all really need to be deposed and replaced by new dynasties, I think.
Evola said that monarchs, and this is writing probably in the 30s or 40s, are more fit to hold tennis rackets than swords these days.
Where did he say that? Which book was that?
Well, I don't remember which book.
That might be Men Among the Ruins, maybe. Yeah, so, he has a bit of a sharp wit, though.
Yeah, but again, the key component... explained it well. The key component to a sane society, European at least, is a strong hierarchy. And it's thankfully, largely in a secular sense, unfortunately, but thankfully, it's more and more younger people are beginning to realize this, and one hopes that this will fuel an eventual, you know, from my viewpoint as a Catholic, an eventual, you know, getting the house in order.
Well, yeah, I mean, you want people, you want these kind of people to go into, you want a sort of, you want a wave of people to go into the priesthood, don't you? Like, I hear a lot previously, like a lot of the people who got into power positions and are now cardinals or whatever, came on this kind of boomer-like wave. They were the boomers, right? And just, they're exactly, I mean, priest boomer is the same as banker boomer, is the same as stay-at-home mom boomer, you know, it's the same stuff. I know, at least in Orthodoxy, in Russia, a lot of the hierarchy at the moment is from that 80s, sometimes 90s era of corruption, sort of going through the end of the Soviet era, whereas a lot of the new entries into the priesthood, and there have been quite a few since religion has kind of bounced back in Russia, are very serious. I mean, people who take their Orthodoxy very seriously, and are, you know, many of them are tsarists, and you have that kind of under. It's just below the surface, but it's coming into that wave of the priesthood, which should be emerging, you know, in the next couple of decades, which will be very interesting to see the kind of effects that has upon Russia.
Yes, and it's you're right. I mean, it's the I discovered the Latin Mass through a priest in my town. It was a different parish than the one that I was attending, and he was a young guy, younger than me. He was maybe, I don't know, maybe 35. This was a few years back, and he was from Poland, and very, very serious. You know, a very, you know, in his, you know, day-to-day moments, he was a very friendly and easygoing and humorous kind of guy. You know, the kids loved him, but he was very serious. But he was the best confessor I ever had, because, I mean, this is another thing that has happened since Vatican II. You know, the sacrament of reconciliation. If you're Catholic or Orthodox, you understand that it's serious. It's you need to do penance, and you know, when you're told to, okay, thank you, you know, it's almost like sometimes the Novus Ordo priests are just going through the motions. They're like, okay, say a couple of Hail Marys. And, you know, this guy was very serious. And, you know, it's interesting you mentioned the Orthodox, Mark. You know, my view of a good, serious priest is, you know, like through Russian literature, like the, you know, the monastery there in the Brothers Karamazov. You know, I mean, and you know, Alyosha, he was a kind of a, you know, obviously because he didn't end up staying there, but he was kind of, but he, you know, that's just been missing. And, you know, getting someone from Poland, in my case, it made a big difference. You know, he came from a country that had recently, you know, freed itself from the yoke of communism, and, you know, he grew up, you know, going to mass, or his relatives grew up going to mass in someone's basement, and
yeah, secret. It's I mean, it's interesting you bring up that book actually, because I've been recently reading up on Oswald Spengler, and his, and something I had no idea about him before is that he had this very deep admiration for Dostoevsky, which I just had never heard about it before.
I didn't know that either, but it doesn't surprise me.
Yeah, because I mean, Spengler is kind of viewed as the sort of arch-German, you know, almost like a precursor to the Nazis, really. And thus you can read some of his works and get a sort of definitely a Slavophobic kind of vibe from them. But that is, I think that's actually quite inaccurate if you look at his full body of work. He almost viewed the Soviet Union as this actually sort of a front, a mask, a betrayal of a deeper kind of Russian soul, which he saw embodied in Dostoevsky. And in fact, he said in his book, Decline of the West, when he was talking about basically, you know, the West has come to the end of its life cycle and is now in this sort of terminal decline stage. It's obviously back in the 19... When was Decline of the West written? I think it was published in the early 30s, maybe late 20s. I'm not entirely sure on that. But he said, you know, at this point, the Soviet Union exists, and it's really the embodiment of Tolstoy. He relates the Soviet Union to this this falsehood, this false Russian identity, which almost tried to ape a European aspect, because Marxism was originally German. And he says that is, it's almost the embodiment of Tolstoy's Christianity. And of course, Spengler has this famous quote, Christianity is the grandmother or something of Bolshevism. But he explained this in more detail by saying that's Tolstoy's Christianity. And he says that actually will eventually decline, that it won't sustain itself. He predicted that the Soviet Union would not last. And he said that actually the next 1,000 years, he believed, firmly in his mind at least, would belong to the kind of Christianity that was talked about by Dostoevsky. And I never knew this about Spengler. Nobody ever sort of discusses this when they write an article on Spengler. And it's encouraged me to actually, I haven't read Decline of the West in its full form, only extracts. It's encouraged me to, I need to pick that up and actually go through it, because I think Spengler may actually be underrated among Christian readers in these circles, just because of, you know, from what we, the preconceptions we have of his works.
Well, it shows. Go ahead. I'm sorry, Clement.
I was going to say, if I could comment on that, I think in Decline of the West, Spengler is complimentary of Dostoevsky and talks about him to a degree. At the same time, I think Spengler betrays a ignorance of Russia and Russian Christianity, because he has this one passage where he says something like, just imagine what a Christianity based on Dostoevsky would look like, or reflected in Dostoevsky would look like. I'm thinking, well, that's Russian Orthodoxy. I mean, that's what
they birthed to life. Well, yeah, in a way, but I think he picked up on, he viewed Russia as, since the time of Peter the Great, and this is somewhat correct in some ways, although I think it's sometimes overstated, as having tried to basically become France, tried to follow France's example. It tried to, in a selective way, pick out aspects of the Enlightenment that it wanted introduced there. And I can't remember the term he uses for this. It's not Petrinism, but it's something like that. It's related to Peter the Great. And he describes that as this kind of mask that's been put over the true Russia. And in a way, you know, I can't really glorify the orthodoxy of the post-Peter the Great era. Because, I mean, the truth about orthodoxy in Russia during that era is it began to go into decline already. I mean, by the time you had Tsar Nicholas II, when he repealed the mandatory requirement for soldiers to go to the service, over 3/4 of them ceased going. So you could already tell it had gone into decline. And actually, Maestre pointed this out. Maestre, who went to Russia famously as the diplomat from the Kingdom of Piedmont Sardinia, he went to the Tsar and actually begged him, do not dismantle the feudal system, because it's the last line of defense you have against modernity. Your priests are all drunk. They won't do anything against it. And, you know, I read that and think, maybe Maestre is just sort of being a little bit high and mighty. But, it was probably true at that time, you know. That I think...
Well, Decay always sets
I like things about that era, but it is overrated in many ways.
If you go back far enough, you can see Decay. I mean, Samuel Adams was complaining about the America immediately following the revolution, because he had envisioned a Christian Sparta that kept the old Puritan New England values. And he already saw people being too extravagant and too interested in material things rather than true Christian virtues and national struggle. So even at the very beginning, you can see the seeds of decay.
It makes sense. I mean, the one thing you could say is Russia has always aimed for, I mean, its ideal has been the Byzantine symphonia between the state and the church. And I think it's fair to say that Russia's never achieved it. It's never, I mean, in the earliest parts during the period of the false Dmitries, the state was so weak that the church really, that was its heyday. That was the church's golden age. It was the only thing that really kept Russia together as any kind of cohesive entity. But then after that, the church went into decline, the state went into ascension, and the state became this sort of very, I think, you know, too large in many ways. I think you can look at the criticisms lodged by Trubetskoy, Kirievsky, against the largesses of the Tsarist state, and that they had infringed on the organic community in many ways. That would seem small fry to Western Europe, where these things were in complete decay and deracination, but it was still a problem in Russia. And it's never struck that balance quite right between the church and the state in the sort of Byzantine ideal. But one can hope for the future, certainly.
Well, Dostoevsky, he was kind of the last, you know, bellwether. You know, he, you know, in his excellent book, Demons, also known as The Possessed, you know, it's pretty much how things turned out, you know, and he was kind of marginalized by his contemporaries, you know, including, of course, Tolstoy and Turgenev, and I haven't read Decline of the West. I want to at some point, of course, but if indeed Spengler did have some admiration for Dostoevsky, it wouldn't surprise me, because you look at Mark, who's an Anglo, and myself, I have my European roots, but I'm an American, and I've always, even you know, in my darkest hours of degeneracy, he's always been my favorite. You know, he's always resonated with me somehow.
I think everyone's loved Dostoevsky. I think Nietzsche loved Dostoevsky. I think Pope Benedict XVI loved Dostoevsky. Certainly, I love what I've read. I've never actually been able to sit down, really complete one of his novels. Unfortunately, I just don't like fiction as much. But yeah, I mean, Dostoevsky is really one of those authors that pretty much anyone can appreciate his depth.
Russian authors never tend to get appreciated in their time. It's always later. Yeah, you know, like Mikhail Bulgakov. Had his
the Master of Margarita
career. Yeah, just destroyed. Just had this. Abysmal, so really good. Tragic life, and then much later this book comes out, and it's just one of the biggest hits in the country long after his death. It's a little bit of a running theme, it seems.
So of course Spengler didn't really look upon Russia as being part of the West, and of course his main thesis is the West, that is basically countries that were dominated by Germanics after the fall of the Roman Empire. That's what really constitutes the West for him. The West is in an irreversible decline, and so he looks to Russia and more broadly the Slavs as possibly the next great civilization.
Yeah, it's quite difficult to determine where he demarcates the West, I think, because, you know, does he talk about the Balkans at all?
I can't remember. I mean, I think he focuses mostly on the Italy, France, Germany, England, Scandinavia, the countries that really
sort of
the heart.
It always interests me in that divide, how the Balkans are always left in this kind of gray area. Because, I mean, they were neither this part of the Europe that was dominated by the Mongols for so long, but nor were they this part that was, you know, free to do its own thing. Because obviously they were under the domination of the Turks for a while. So, I mean, it's unclear which sort of world they fit into, or if they're their own world. I mean, I am reminded slightly of the fact that I mean it's a little bit of a mixture, and of course you got Muslims down in Albania, but I am reminded a little bit of before World War One, the supposedly Western Europeans didn't even consider the people in the Balkans to be really civilized at all. They called them Balkan monkeys.
Or the Balkans were under the rule of Austria.
Well, yeah, you had those parts under, like, Slovenia and Croatia.
Wasn't it you, Mark, who said there was a joke in the Balkans around World War One? Was checking the time?
Oh, yeah, yeah. Well, I mean, that was what it was like at the time. Didn't you? You know, what time is it by your bomb? There were anarchists everywhere. It was, you know.
I'm sorry, but I just have in my head now. Hey, hey, we're the Balkans.
People say we balking around.
Oh. Oy vey.
I just completely torpedoed, you know, all of the superb intellectual and philosophical depth that everyone's built up.
Oh, we're just shooting okay. The shit.
So sorry.
Are you a Monkees fan, Lumen?
Lord, no.
Oh.
Well, I mean,
I feel like I think I'm the only Monkees fan in the alt right.
There's got to be one in every crowd, I guess.
Yep. I've seen every episode of the show, and I have all the albums.
What do you define as a monkey, though?
That's probably.
Are you familiar with the band The Monkees, the musical group from the 60s?
Nope.
It's not that old, Ian.
Really? Is that because you're a mulatto?
Hey, don't even go there.
Okay. You put it in your Twitter profile, I'm just saying.
Yes. Yes, I did, because most people would assume I was white. A straight white, an evil straight white male.
Oh, I see, so it's all front.
Yes, it's the woke half Negro.
I don't think I've met a Monkees fan anywhere under any circumstances, let alone.
Well, you have now.
Okay, then.
I think maybe my mother, but that's it.
Yeah, I think my dad's got their CD somewhere.
Yeah, I'm not familiar with their music. I know the House of the Rising Sun. I like their.
That's the animal.
Yeah, that's the animal.
Animals, monkeys. Oh, well, yeah. I tried.
Yeah, actually, the three living members, because we lost Davy Jones in 2012, they actually came out with a new album last year. Not bad.
Well, I remember they did that movie called Head, and
yeah.
It was actually like, you know, at the time I was kind of a hippie, kind of like a deadhead, sort of, you know, and I kind of thought that was cool. It was different from their other stuff. It was kind of like their attempt to be psychedelic and. But I guess they were one of those bands that they didn't know how to play their instruments. They were put together, you know, like someone probably, you know, no offense to anyone, you know, someone probably with the last name of Stein, you know, put them together. And
Bob Berg.
Yep.
Schneider.
Yep.
I think they were Jewish.
Yes. Yeah, and but. They didn't know how to play their instruments, and they're first hit was, I mean, I'm kind of ashamed I know all this. So I just sort of accumulate useless trivia, but it was that song. Yeah, the last train to Clarksville, I think. Yes. And they didn't know how to play their instruments. And
well, actually, slight correction. They do know how to. They did have some musical talent. I mean, Peter Cork, he's a multi-instrumentalist. Mike Nesmith can play the guitar. Mickey
but they
Dolan
had to, they had to use like studio like sessions musicians,
right?
To put together their first stuff.
What, their first two albums were done with studio musicians, and is there a bird chirping?
Bird chirping, there is.
Cool.
Yes, because I'm on my way back from my job, basically.
Okay.
You clearly haven't read Ian's strict rules against any celebration of life or, you know, happiness. That's verboten.
It's haram, man. Shut it down.
Absolutely haram.
But why we only have
Oy vey, shut it down.
But anyway, back to the Monkees, because this is the most important thing we've talked about all night.
I am so sorry once again.
The third album, they actually did play the instruments, and from then on, and then an album after that, they played some of the instruments. Mainly Mike Nesmith and Peter Tork played instruments on that album, but the others didn't really want to because. Mickey Dolenz and Davy Jones were actors first and foremost, so they were fine just singing and not playing the instruments and going through all the studio takes. So that was.
So are you a fan of the show? In addition to being a fan of music.
Sorry, what's that?
Are you a fan of the show? In addition to being a fan
of
music,
I have
a TV show.
I have both
right?
DVD. So. I've seen every episode of the Monkees. Yeah.
Did you see the special that they had in the Balkans?
No, I did not. I, did see 33 and 1/3 revolutions per monkey, though. That was,
it was kind of disjointed.
But actually, it was pretty disjointed. Have you seen that, Lumen? 33 and 1/3 revolutions per monkey?
No.
It was a TV special they did where they got a bunch of musical guests on, but it seemed to focus more on the musical guests than them, and it was kind of just kind of a weird musical extravaganza from the late 60s with some weird psychedelic elements to it, and yeah, it wasn't that great.
You know what? You know what's fascinating is that the discussion that, you know, again, which I unceremoniously took a match to, you know, that was the kind of thing that was a normal topic of discussion for folks like us, you know, a century ago. And, you know, the conversation we're having right now, again, part of it is just for fun and goofing around. But that is more of what people are sort of used to these days. It's just interesting. It's sad, but it's also kind of interesting. I mean, it was quite normal to have a somewhat philosophical conversation about literature and religion.
I think it just depends on what circles you run in. I mean,
yeah.
I imagine even in the old days, most lower class people didn't have those kind of discussions.
Oh yeah,
unless they were the more literary types. I remember
Shudras don't talk about that stuff.
What's that, Mark?
Shudras don't talk about that stuff. This is strictly Brahmin tier.
Yeah. Well, I remember John Derbyshire said something like, he was talking about growing up in rural England back in the 50s, and he said people of an unsocial temperament tended to either drink a lot or read a lot. He said, and I came from a family of readers.
No, better than coming from a family of drinkers.
You do, you said?
No, I'm saying
better. That it's better then.
Yeah.
I have to admit that I did both.
Even working class people can be readers. They're just not socially inclined.
Well, I was going to say, speaking of popular culture, culture for less educated people, I was always struck by the fact that during the Middle Ages, the lives of the saints or the mystery plays based on scripture, that was popular entertainment. So even if common people weren't debating mystic philosophy, they were thinking about God and about the saints and about salvation throughout the day, and it was
a theme.
So even though it wasn't high culture necessarily, it was still very Christian through and through.
Yeah, you have to remember this was going on at that time. I mean, this was the era of saints actually existing in the world. You know, you could potentially meet somebody who would then become a saint. You don't really see that today. I mean, there's the one-off, of course, but I mean, it largely died at the beginning of the last century, really. I mean,
and that was at the point in the cycle of history where you know, Rome had just gone up in flames with the plebes, you know, engaging in bread and circuses and, you know, orgiastic entertainment. It was
I can think of three saints, and you know, this proves maybe that I'm not a great Orthodox. I can think of three saints from the last 100 or so years. I can think of St. John of Kronstadt, St. Mary of Paris, and St. Seraphim Rose. That's literally, I mean, just not another one is coming to mind as being like a notable quotable for me. Wow. And it's just, you know, they dry up, you know.
No, it's not a joke. Because you mentioned that with being close to saints, I'm actually, I guess technically by proximity, one person removed from a recent Orthodox saint. Like, I know someone who knew that person.
Oh, really?
Yes. I'm not going to say, well, yeah, I don't know. I'm not going to say who, because it kind of relates to the unique situation that I'm in locally. But yeah, no, I mean, it is possible. I mean, I'm trying to think of, you know, I was kind of joking. I don't know if you heard me saying like, wow, Mark, as you were saying, going through the three, but I can name at least, I mean, I can name at least another three on top of that. Probably even a bit more, but I mean,
You gotta delve into books to read about this,
this kind of stuff. I mean, I'm sort of reading about St. John of Kronstadt recently. It's just they don't get, I mean, they don't really get mentioned as much anymore. Really not like in the old days.
Not so much in the West, or I think in America as a whole, there's really not much of an emphasis.
I mean, I guess just miracles happen less, you know, healings and things like that. I don't think they're as common as they once were, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah, just speak up for the Protestant side and say that all redeemed people are saints in the biblical sense.
Lack of saints, defeatist Christians, etc.
Oh, man.
But now, the point I was making was more about popular culture or less educated people would talk about. And in the past, was still very edifying when people talked about scripture and talked about God how he acted in the world and what he did for them in their lives, not just the Middle Ages, but in the United States as well.
Now I just talk about buttholes.
Well, yeah, I mean, an example that comes to mind too is in, I think, at least up to the 16th century in Russia, you would teach on children to read by using the Psalter. So you'd have the child read the Psalter, and that's how you would teach them how to read. I mean, just basic things like
good
that
idea.
That we don't use anymore.
Well, I guess they have to use a primitive that's somewhat easier at first, but Psalter's good. You should always say the Psalter.
Oh, hold on. I was totally wrong. There's a fourth one I know. St. John of Shanghai. That's another one I read about. How could I forget him? It's actually quite important.
Shanghai, huh?
Well, Shanghai. He missioned Shanghai. So I gotta say, yeah, San Francisco. So I think that's where he's originally sort of based.
Well, no, he was from Russia. Then was in Yugoslavia, or I guess, I don't know if it was called that back then, but he was, you know, in modern-day Serbia.
Didn't he have a church in San Francisco?
He did eventually, but he was first made the bishop of Shanghai. And then he was actually assigned to Western Europe, where he was for about 10 years. And then he was assigned at the very end of his life to San Francisco. And he died about 6 years after coming to America, and he was buried in the cathedral in San Francisco.
Yeah, that makes perfect sense. I think I read something about him. He was involved in the canonization of St. John of Kronstadt.
He was the official sort of recognition. Of Kronstadt, and also he pushed for St. Herman of Alaska.
Damn, there's another one. So when was Herman of Alaska around? That's old, isn't it?
1794.
It's not that
over
old.
Here.
Yeah.
But...
So what do you gentlemen, speaking of saints, you know, one thing that we learn as Catholics is, you know, it's like sooner or later a priest will, you know, try to trip you up and say, is everyone in heaven a saint? And you know, you think about old Uncle Thomas, you know, he was such a faithful guy, but you know, I don't know if he's a saint, but you know, we're told the answer is yes. I mean, because you have to be holy to go to heaven. So I mean, we have this. I just ask because we have this image of saints as someone to aspire to. There's always a line of demarcation that it seems. I think few of us, especially if you're humble, you know, you kind of think of yourself crossing that line.
Yeah, no, I'd be careful to apply the. I'd just be careful to apply the saint label to anyone sort of flippantly, just because I apply it to martyrs. Yeah, the only group of people who I'd apply it to who are not, you know, officially recognized by the church as saints would be martyrs, because there are martyrs who are not recognized by the church as yet, and the church acknowledges it. The church actually says, at least I think the Orthodox one does. I don't know if the Catholic says the same thing, that there are more unrecognized saints than there are recognized ones, people who in their life did things that were worthy of being canonized, but the church just didn't get around to it or doesn't know about it.
And that's the point. That's yeah. the point of this. You know, that it's a at least in Catholicism, it's a way that priests get people to think about. You know, do your best to be holy. Aspire to be holy all the time.
So the things the people you know are in heaven that you know.
Yeah.
That
yeah.
Yeah, and they can intercede for you, and you know. So yeah, but I only put martyrs in that category. Like, even if somebody has been a really good, you know, a good person, I don't think you can say with certainty. You know, I think it's presumptuous to think so.
Well, go ahead, Clement.
Oh,
I was just going to say, as a technical question, so can people in purgatory intercede on your behalf, or maybe they can't? I don't know. I have no clue. It just occurred to me as a question.
No, they can't, and not until they get to heaven. We can pray for them. And actually, I prayed a decade of the rosary the other day for the souls in purgatory. And now that I mention it, I also prayed a decade for everyone in our hangout. I prayed that you know, God protect us, and that we all do our best to do His work, the work that He has to do for us.
Yeah,
Orthodoxy doesn't have a good
story. What?
I hear like
That's my freedom. Damn it! Oh. Trying to put ice cream in the freezer because I'm a fat slob.
I thought you said that's my freedom.
That's my freezer, not freedom.
I'll never take my freezer.
I heard freedom too.
I heard freedom.
I heard freezer.
Freedom, if you're talking about freedom in the liberal sense, it's not a good thing because it's degenerate.
Freedom is too wild.
People freedom have too much freedoms what? Now. But freedom from Christianity, it's like, that's not good.
Yeah.
That's the freedom you have no right to.
Well, you do have a right, but you're not going to save your soul.
That don't make it right.
Ain't going to go anywhere except for hell.
Yep. It's like,
where would God send good people to hell? Maybe they weren't good people.
Well, that kind of ties in.
Needs to accept Christianity and turn away from Islam, or else he'll go to hell.
Well, this kind of ties in with what I was going to say about the, you know, are you a saint, you know, when you go to heaven. You know, C.S. Lewis said that you might be surprised, you know, on the day of judgment at, you know, someone who in, you know, the course of your life, the day-to-day dealings you've had with this person seemed like they were sinful, seemed like they were angry, whatever. And once, you know, everything is stripped away to the soul, you know, you might be surprised at who ends up going to heaven, and conversely, you know, who might end up going to hell, you know, because they were actually pharisaical. You never know.
That's a Catholic. How would you determine who goes to heaven? Because I have nothing on it. I'm not too. I don't know much about Catholic being one of these dirty Protestants you hear about.
You go to heaven if you're in God's grace. You know, and again, you know, no one knows for certain except for God. You know, a Catholic can say with certainty, you know, who has gone to heaven, who has gone to hell. I mean, you can surmise probably to a fairly, you know, certain degree, but you know, if you die, you know, with no mortal sin, and you're, you know, and this is why, you'll hear, you know, about Catholics, you know, praying, or if they can, getting the last rites. You know, it's but again, it's up to God. God only knows. God only know. You know, God is a searcher of hearts. You know, God is the only one who sees us for who we really are.
Yeah.
So was that the Catholic position back in the 16th century that Protestants could be saved, or was it more definite that they?
That's more modernity with Pope Francis, I think.
I would
assume it's a thing of modernity, because Catholics persecuted Protestants pretty bad back then, and that was the whole 30 Years' War was about.
And we still do it when no one's looking. You know, that's a little inside baseball for you guys. Don't tell anyone.
Is it true what Jack Chick says about how there's some computer in the Vatican that will help?
Like everything Jack Chick says is true.
No, Jack Chick.
Nothing wrong.
Well, something like Jack Chick. He did something on communism. I remember like, I always have my issues with Chick. First, I had a problem because he was like all the average anti-communist. And when I became a fascist, then I'm like, you're saying fascism's Jesuitical. That's full of crap. Pure bogus. Call baloney on that one, Chick.
Well, this is what happens when, you know, we all know that when somewhat passionate, volatile young men are denied their career in art, you know, sometimes incendiary views may prevail over their, their better sense. Maybe Jack Chick is one of them. I guess he wanted to be a comic artist for like Marvel or DC, and he was rejected.
That was a great setup in transition.
Thank you.
Well, I asked about the 16th century view of the Catholic Church, because I know there's a debate in Protestantism if people, if salvation's by faith alone, could Catholics who didn't believe in salvation by faith alone actually be saved? Richard Hooker came down.
I don't think Catholicism ever has. I think it's always been like through a state of grace and a bunch of other stuff.
Well, I mean, the bottom line, and I can't speak to the historical debate about this. I bet Mark might be able to, but the bottom line is the Catholic Church, like most other churches, is, you know, that one of the firm points of dogma is that this is how you save your soul, through the church. And that's, you know, that kind of, I guess precludes any sort of, you know, appeals to semantics and to conditions, circumstances, etc.
Mm.
I'm sorry. That's the best. That's the best answer I can give.
I believe at least there is some. I may be wrong about this. There is some sort of leeway given to the period, the pre-Christian period. So the, in other words, people who existed at the time of Christ would have been Christians, essentially. But just because of the time period they existed beforehand, if God knows in their conscience that they were sort of irreconcilable to him, that they would be. I've read that somewhere. I'm not 100% sure on that. That's what I read somewhere.
Or based on how they responded to the logos as men.
Well, they were ignorant at the time. They didn't know who.
Kind of get around the idea of, you know, that common sort of atheist complaint of, well, what about everyone who existed before the time of Christ? You know, they always say that. I've heard that trotted out about three times now. It's reasonable to assume that God would know, you know, and God will know his own.
I think part of the problem comes from the fact that, you know, I know obviously Dante and his. Divine Comedy is not dogma, but he actually places all the pre-Christian philosophers, I think, in limbo. He doesn't actually give them the beatific vision. But obviously Dante was never dogma. I mean, it's just his sort of private interpretation. But
yeah, like I've heard it about Aristotle before. Like someone said, oh, if Aristotle had been born just a bit later, he would have definitely been a Christian, just because of some of the things he said were almost like precursors.
I mean, you can say that about Aristotle. You could probably say that about Plato, too.
Mm. Yeah.
But anyways. Oops.
I did just, in this time, I have thought of another saint that I forgot, which was Vukasin of Klepshi, which is another one, you know. So you think about it a little more and they start to come to you. But what I mean is that there's no, you know, we don't have a St. John Chrysostom with today, you know. You don't have somebody of that caliber.
Well, Mark, there was Saint Nikolai Velimirovic, who was the new Chrysostom of Serbia, who died in 1956.
See, there's somebody I've never heard about. What's the name?
Yeah, I haven't either.
Saint Nikolai
Velimirovic. I probably am butchering the name, but you can find him online.
Nikolai
Velimirovic. Yeah, he actually knew St. John of Shanghai and San Francisco when St. John was in Serbia. In fact, he actually said, if you want to meet a living saint, go up and see Father John. But St. Nikolai, he was in Serbia really throughout World War I and World War II. And then afterwards, he may have been exiled or he may have just come over here and not been able to return. But he ended up becoming rector of St. Tikhon's Orthodox Seminary in South Canaan, Pennsylvania.
Yes.
And he died there in 1956.
He probably had the lead probably because of Tito's socialist government.
I think that's what it was. But eventually his body was returned to Serbia, where it is today.
It's of course that.
I'm just looking at his page. I'm just looking at his page now, and so there's a little section subtitled "Alleged Anti-Semitism." So I know that this guy's probably pretty good.
Well, no, Oy Vey, next case, Oy Vey, shut it down.
Whenever they put that on, like an Orthodox, it's literally
It's like a seal of approval.
Well, no, I'm just reading it now. I'm just reading it's a little thing, a little paragraph, and it actually ends exactly the same way as one that I've read on three other profiles. It's like a copy paste job. It is a seal of approval. It's just like, and it always finishes with their statements are historically no different than that in the Bible or what Christians have been saying for centuries. Oh well, you think, you know.
Well, I see a lot of these is heretics like John Hagee saying the Jews don't have to be saved.
He's just literally he's subhuman.
Yeah,
he's an idiot.
He's a bug man. He's
despite
a bug man.
Despite everything that Saint Paul says in Romans about how he would, you know, that he would rather go to Gehenna himself if he could save, you know,
Saint Paul in Romans basically torpedoes really any sort of argument that there's still the old covenant that's valid at least.
Just don't even entertain this garbage. It's utter trash.
It's like, oh, he says this, and it's really it's after what the Jews had done. They've been basically kind of a lot of them have been blinded. It's another thing. So they're ignorant. They're blinded. So they kind of have no clue. Which is still sad.
Microwave to idiocy for people in sort of. The United States who kind of have this geopolitical relationship with Israel and are like, oh, we must fight Iran for the Jews.
I don't like Iran by any means, but Israel is fully capable of defending itself as it's shown throughout its existence.
Yeah, well,
I'm sorry I'm late, guys.
I'd ally with Iran before I lied with Israel, for crying out loud. Persians never done anything to me.
Okay. I love it. The Israelis.
I'm sorry. I'm late.
The Middle East, Palestinians.
Oh, sorry. I think we have too many people talking at once. Real quick, I just want to say, Britain. I mean, I didn't want to let go too long. We're coming up on 3 hours, so we might not have you in here for too long. But we can hang around afterwards.
Yeah. I was having some technical difficulties, but man, I'm sorry, Miss. Yeah, I was saying I'm sorry I missed so much of the call. I mean, this sounds like a one that I'd really enjoy.
Well, actually, we just happened to get on that subject of alleged anti-Semitism.
Anti-Semitism. I'm gonna jump on my computer.
I thought this was I thought this was a birthday bash. I'm sorry.
Uh-oh, Delta. Do you want your face on camera? Okay, now there's two of you.
Oy vey. I don't know. I'm not against Hebrews. I'm just against Pharisees. So
I didn't mean for that to happen at all.
Yeah.
I'm with Louis.
I just want them to be in their own place, just far away. Just don't screw around.
Their own place.
Where I am,
I'm kind of under the convert opinion.
Convert Jewish people should get saved. Yeah, that's how I am too in a lot of ways. And of course, all the Hagee people would say I'm anti-Semitic and that I'm not a true
saved
Christian.
Or get wrecked.
I'm so anti-Semitic. Ooh.
My mom even doesn't like the fact that I say she doesn't even like how I'm critical sometimes of the Jews. It's not even on a
I'm literally.
It's more religious.
I'm pretty critical. Religion. I was having lunch with my parents, and I told my parents that at least tactically I kind of liked Hezbollah.
I'm curious. How did Chinese parents take that news?
Did she say Oy vey in Mandarin?
Well, one, we don't speak Mandarin.
I'm sorry.
Cantonese. Cantonese.
Yeah.
Wrong Chinese.
No, she was just like, why? I mean, like, don't they oppose Israel? Blah, blah, blah. I'm like, okay, first of all. Let's talk about the Bible and the Hebrews. I've basically been ridiculing my parents about the Pharisees for the past year and some. So
it's really hard.
New Year sits his parents down. We need to have a discussion about the Jews.
Well, my little stance on that conflict is I'm not going to support a bunch of Mohammedans who shoot rockets at civilians. So. That's where I'm at.
I don't care. It's not my conflict. It's not. It's like Kashmir.
Mohammedans can get blown up by the Israeli Air Force, and I really give no shits.
Either way, I give no shits. It's Christian land by right. So
I mean,
that's my opinion.
In
terms of,
it can be ethnically Jewish. It just needs to be Christian.
Exactly.
That's my opinion.
The Muslims are pretty bad, but...
Oh, the Palestinians are troublemakers.
But Zionism is antichrist, so... So I have no desire to support that.
It's a more sinister, and it's a more effective and far-reaching sort of ideology than some idiot in Berkeley wearing a keffiyeh and, you know, whatever, at a protest. You know, they're two different things. And you really wouldn't have one without the other.
And spiritually, the thing needs to fail. Like, the Zionist project without Christ, this is direct disobedience of God, because we know what the conditions are for return from exile. We know this from the Old Testament, when God kicks them out of the Holy Land the first time, they go to Babylon, and the condition for returning to the Holy Land after 70 years is repentance. And I guess at that time, the Hebrews were back. Right. So Daniel prayed, and sure, I'm not going to say that all of the Hebrews were repentant, but at least God counted it as such, and he returned them to the land. It wasn't, and he didn't, in the self-understanding of the Hebrews, they weren't fully returned from exile because they didn't have a Davidic king and stuff like that, but there was some kind of return there. But by the time we get around to the Romans, they're still had. They've had Nehemiah, and then they've had the Hasmonean kingdom, and then that's been destroyed, and the Romans are in. So they feel that... That they've suffered a setback in this return from exile, and this theme of exile continues, you know, to Andalus. The poets of Halevi talk about this kind of stuff, right? And he's even the kind of guy who, eventually he made it back to the Holy Land, but that doesn't mean he's not in exile even when he's back in the Holy Land. So. The thing that they're trying to have now, this return from exile without Christ, it's going to fail. It has to fail. And it's like the time that that God told Israel that because they were not faithful and they refused to enter the Holy Land because they were freaked out by the Canaanites and their height and stuff like that, that they would not enter his rest. And so they didn't enter his rest. But some of these people, actually, we do want to go take the Holy Land. Yeah, and then they just get beaten back by the Canaanites. Now, on the time scale that we're looking at, sure, it's longer than that. It's been, 60 years now? But 60 years is not a very long time. I mean, one Chinese dynasty lasts about 300 years. So there's plenty of time for this to fail. And
God, does that mean there's like, does that mean there's like 200 more years of communism left in China or what?
That doesn't even exist now. Yeah, China's not communist.
Well, right, but that logic, the Chinese Republic
didn't last. It doesn't really depend on
the party. Say again. Well,
the Chinese Republic didn't even last for probably way less than 50, I think.
Well, it's...
it's in Taiwan
it
now.
It's the name in Taiwan, but...
Yeah, it's basically about 100 if you count Taiwan, yeah.
But it's basically but, a...
Yeah, the mainland's
an
dead.
American shill puppet.
It's a rump thing.
I don't call that much of a Republic of China. I mean, under Chiang Kai-shek, it was still.
I like the KMT. I would still prefer the return of a dynasty in China. That's been a historical form of government in China. So, I think the only way a republic would work is in the states. Outside of that, it's.
It depends what you're calling a republic too, right? Because Polybius would just say all of these are different constitutions of republic. You can have a monarchical constitution for a republic, or you can have a democratic constitution or a mixed constitution or whatever. But
it needs somebody in the Forbidden City again. The Forbidden City needs to be forbidden again, and no more tourists entering there.
Well, that depends. That depends if the capital is there. Might or might not be the best place for a capital.
It might be Nanking or something like that.
Might be Nanking.
Oh, man, moving the capital.
Nanking is Japland. Don't even speak of that.
Expel the Japs.
But I mean, you've got to have like a Han. You've got to have a Han on the throne and not some Manchu Mongol.
Oh, I mean, okay.
In terms of the Chinese Empire, cool.
I'm fine with having a Manchu. To a Korean, a Viet, or a Jap on the throne in Beijing.
A Viet?
If they're not imposing some kind of basically a racial caste system as the Manchus did between...
If they're not making you cut your hair in like a ponytail?
Yeah. So
Louis
none of that.
I do not want a ponytail. Note this down.
I do not want a ponytail. I do not want a tonsure in the front of my head. I do not want... Yeah, no, I want to be wearing... Chinese clothes, there can be a bit of, mixing with Turanian cultures as there was in the Tang Dynasty, but it has to be, it has to be Chinese.
Okay, question, do you want to own Korea? Do you think Korea should be incorporated into China?
I think Korea, Japan, and Vietnam should just be part of the Chinese Empire, but have the opportunity to be emperors of... The whole empire, but realistically,
that ain't gonna work, though, because all Chinese, Koreans, and Japs hate each other, so it's not going to work.
Well, that's not the thing.
I mean, way back when Germans and French hated each other, and now they're in some sort of weird union together.
Well, North and South Koreans don't even like each other. They consider each other different.
They hate each other partly because of America and some other stuff.
Yeah. And they hate Japan because of the whole colonialism thing.
Louis is like the Thiriart of the East. He's going to make a sort of like an empire.
Well, I mean, I've explicitly quoted him in an article on arcmedia.com.
Japan needs another restoration.
But
based. I'm actually going to read through some Thiriart of him.
Japan needs another restoration right after somebody nukes Akihabara.
No more nukes, please. That's what destroyed Christianity in Japan.
Yeah. By the way, how do you rationalize nuking the only Christian center of Japan? Like Nagasaki, I believe, was the Christian hub of Japan. Yeah.
It was an Irish Catholic that dropped the bomb too. At least that's what I've heard.
Oh, so potatoes.
Bloody mix. Not
he,
even
he was
once.
Just he was actually just reaching for his Guinness, I've heard.
And whoops, I dropped one on Nagasaki.
Yeah, this is why
they've
got to be
for me, Jameson's.
They've got to be dominated by the English. I'm sorry. You know, you can't trust them. You can't.
Funny how my mom's in there. I got a bit of the Anglo, but not much.
I ain't getting into that one. I'm a teaching. We do not know anything.
Yeah, so no Mick. So Mickey just needs to stay out.
I'm ashamed of is the fact that I have Dutch DNA in me, and that's, you know, I mean, if you saw the stuff about you know, the whole Christian Revolution or the Christian Revolt in Japan, and find out that the Dutch were supporting the Shinto or the, you know, yeah, the were basically against the Christian Revolt. Oh yeah, hey, we're gonna support these people that are, you know, mass killing Christians. All right.
What's the Dutch, like, were supportive of it?
Yeah, the Dutch were against it. I think the Portuguese were the ones that were, you know, helping the Catholics.
Wow.
Know, do the whole thing.
This is why colonialism is bad for Europeans. Just stop it. You're just going to kill Christians.
The thing is, I'm not even surprised that the Dutch did that. Fucking clogs, no, not even once.
The eternal Dutchman. Although I will say,
they can't vote for Garrett Wilders in the election.
The eternal windmill. It's not
happening. The eternal windmill.
They can't even vote for a populist. They're that bad.
Jeez.
Lord.
I'll literally give them greater deeds land, but then they're going to be under German admin.
Okay, so either the Dutch need to be... Yeah, no, never mind. Yeah, the Dutch need to be recognized as not European. Can we like lump them in with, I don't know.
Turks.
Well, yeah, I was going to say they're going to be Turkey soon. They're going to be a client state of Turkey.
No, I think you mean a client state of Morocco, not Turkey. Germany's Turks. But yeah, obviously Hitler didn't do nothing when he took away their bicycles because, you know, they're clearly a threat to everybody.
Yeah. Yeah. Beware of the eternal Jew. But I mean, once you get rid of him, you know, watch out for that knife sticking out of your back from the eternal Dutchman.
Dutch.
It was a bit of a shock when I found out that I had some of that in me.
Oh, actually,
why base Portuguese, which some people...
Yeah, yeah, don't go.
I see a lot of the white nationals railing on me for having Portuguese, and it's like, what's wrong with the Portuguese? Oh, they're race mixers, man. Had the longest lasting empire, so shut up.
Portuguese are usually okay. Portuguese and Anglos.
Yeah, a lot of white nationals hate them, though, because they were filthy race mixers.
The race mixing of the Portuguese has produced some nice...
Oh, Brazilians? Man.
No more so than the Greeks. No more so than the Greeks. And I sit in church with Greeks, so I'm fine.
Well, was Plinio Correa de Oliveira, was he Portuguese or was he Brazilian? He wrote that book. He was the founder of the...
Say the name again.
Plinio Correa, I'm probably mispronouncing it, de Oliveira. And he was the founder of, they're still around today, the Foundation for Tradition and Property. And he was either Portuguese or Brazilian. But he's like a very admirable reactionary. He wrote this book called Revolution and Counter-Revolution.
I've never heard of him.
Yeah, I bet you'd like him, Mark. I haven't delved too deeply into it.
All I've got in my head is Olivier Salazar and Plinio Salgado.
Oh, are you talking about the Estado Novo, or best state in Portuguese history?
I think he was actually Brazilian, but he might have, I mean, either way, he spoke Portuguese. But,
The Estado Novo were not cucks, unlike the filthy Anglos who gave up their colonies. The Portugal actually fought to keep them, despite the UN trying to take them away 50 times.
That's the benefit of being under an autocrat, you know.
Okay, yeah, he was Brazilian.
It's better for the Anglos to be cucks about their colonies than to spread jewelry.
Portugal is not so much cuck.
You know what, Louis, I actually agree with you 100%, man. I fucking agree.
Yeah, colonialization.
I mean,
it might be
too much.
It might be my inner Portuguese that makes me so biased for Portugal's colonial policy.
I'm fine with Portugal. It's It's the Spaniards who had designs on conquering China. They abandoned that, but yeah, the Jesuits were talking. The Jesuits.
Well, see, I don't mind. I don't mind Spain's model for colonization, because when they conquer a nation, they make damn sure it becomes Christian. So I don't mind that. But yeah, the other models of, hey, we're gonna go ahead and colonize you, and you can still be you. You don't have to convert or anything.
If my history is correct, Luigi, the Chinese actually were the ones who collapsed the Spanish Empire. Am I right on that? Because wasn't there something to do with you flooding the market with silver coins, and it basically just destroyed?
Oh, yeah. Was it the Manchu? Was it the Manchus who needed a lot of silver coins for stuff?
I just remember we did a module on it in history, and there were all these stories about the Chinese, like under the nose of the Spanish, had these boats full of coins, and they were smuggling them in, and it just inflated the currency to the point where it was worthless.
Compared with the amount of silver coming in from Peru, I think that's an implausible cause. Besides which, I think China needed silver themselves. So
yeah, I think it was for money. Could have been wrong. Yeah.
And maybe it was the other way around. Maybe Spain collapsed China's economy. Maybe that's what I'm thinking.
That's more likely.
And that paid the English just humiliated them.
I mean, China didn't do nothings, okay?
Well, China.
Well, I mean,
we were dynasties and shit.
Well, China's been humiliated by a number of countries, by the Anglos, like twice, yeah, and by Japan.
I've been singing a patriotic song about that since I was 3. So yes, we were peaceful and shit, and peaceful night was torn asunder by the cannon fire of the Westerners. That's not exactly what the lyrics say, but everyone understands what it means.
But what do you guys think of like the whole Taiping Rebellion that happened in China during the 1860s?
Well, it's very interesting for one.
Quite eventful, but helped the Manchus. I know that helped the Manchus put it down.
Not as memorable as when the Nips invaded Nanking. They raped Nanking.
Well, it is.
Oh, Japan still won't apologize for that as well.
Yeah.
It is a Chinese what happens when you have a Chinese or when you have a Christian cult that just does weird shit. But
I think Taiping.
On the Nanking thing. Am I coming in? Is my audio?
I brought up Taiping. That's off the quest for a bit.
Okay. Yeah, I wasn't getting the little notification or the little sound bar. But yeah, on the Nanking bar, I'm kind of on the side of you know that animated GIF of, you know, oh look, yet another Japanese war crime denial thread. I'm kind of on the side of that, because I mean, if you think about it, the Japanese are probably the most they make Nazis look like straight up, you know, diversity loving hippies.
Well, the Japs are brutal and they chimp out, so
they're pretty bad. Right.
Well, I mean, you know, if you think about, you know, how they value, I mean, like the North Koreans value their racial purity. If the Japanese value their racial purity, you'd think that they'd avoid, you know, race mixing like the plague.
Well, I think you may be viewing it wrong there.
Maybe.
Like their racialist views are not really equivalent to Germany's.
If you just rape some foreign women and don't do anything about the children, then that's not much race mixing as far as you're concerned, because you're just...
It also wasn't very genetic as well. Like, I'm very questionable on the Japanese knowledge of genetics at this point. It certainly was not where the German knowledge was. You know, I think their racism was far more sort of older, you know. What I mean is it was more implicit, whereas, you know, in Europe you had a very explicit.
So they were more about homosexuality or what?
More implicit. The last
they had.
Stand of
Japan had
implicit white identity. What?
Stand of implicit white identity, yes. We know, Dickie Spencer.
Oh, wait, no, I got it. Rape is the last implicit stand of Japanese implicit Japanese identity.
No, it's the last implicit stand of Indian identity.
No, that's
shitting in the street is the Diane.
I think Bangladesh is good too, though.
Designated shitting street.
Well, I think they shit in the river, though.
Yeah, nice. Yeah, but the Japanese were pretty.
Okay. So yeah. Indians shit in the river, and Chinamen. That was the
Bangladeshis.
That you could drink them.
Because Bangladesh is like right at the Bay of Bengal world where the rivers meet up, like in the Himalayas and all that.
Oh, Bangladesh.
And they're in that delta, so it's like a disaster over there, probably.
I'd rather visit Burma than Bangladesh.
You can travel to Bangladesh by visiting London.
Well, I know Burma, like, they persecute the Muslims, like, they never gets mad at them for it.
No, yeah, I heard about that. Off.
The Buddhists just got fed up with them and started attacking them.
Yeah, I love that. The Buddhist, there was an interview with that Buddhist that I watched, and it's like, you know how Duterte just didn't give a fuck when
killing the dragons.
The UN. Yeah, when the UN was like, that's infringing on human rights, he was like, go suck a, you know what, buddy. And, you know, the Buddhist was essentially had the same attitude, like, you know, oh, we're imposing on human rights. Oh, yeah, well, go ahead and try to stop us.
Oh, what are you going to do about it? That's what.
Yeah.
I remember during the Iran's era of Ahmadinejad, people would probably complain about him. A lot. mainly pro-Israelis. They just hated him, like, really bad. And that guy just didn't give a crap.
Ahmadinejad?
Yeah, in Iran. He was the former president of Iran.
Oh, yeah, I remember
him. Hitler of our time, according to everybody at one point.
Actually, what's funny is... something I found out is apparently Iran actually has the highest number of sex changes in the world.
I thought it was China. Brazil. I guess not.
But apparently, according to Ahmadinejad, remember when Ahmadinejad said that there are no gay people in Iran?
Yeah,
that's true.
I guess that settles the age-old question of, are traps really gay?
Well, I know that. I guess there's no gays in Chechnya either.
Yeah.
No, there aren't. These places don't have that concept. They don't have that concept, so it just doesn't exist.
Well, what's funny about Chechnya, that's the only Muslim area that the leftists are just whining about. They mostly will ignore Muslims attacking gays unless it's Chechnya.
Which, I mean, I don't care. I mean, I'm totally for them removing that filth. But
I'm pretty much inclined to, with how the left is complaining about Chechnya, that makes me inclined to actually support Chechnya.
Yeah, same.
Well, it's just
even though they're Islamic. I think it's because they're part of Russia.
You know why they're doing it. It's because you can then technically do a headline which says, Russia putting gays in concentration camps.
Oh, yes.
And then just a byline. Oh, by the way, it's in this region called Chechnya, which basically the Russian federal government has literally no control of.
Well, it's literally Muslim.
Well, like, you know, I think Putin's really appreciative of it, because, I mean, you know, at least... these Chechens aren't, they're doing something productive that he doesn't really care about, and, you know, not inciting civil war like they usually do. So I think he's just happy that he's got a little bit of a break from them.
Yeah,
I know America has this kind of like mythical view of Russia as this kind of Hitlerist dictatorship, but honestly, the amount of autonomy given to individual states is probably more akin to the pre-Civil War United States than the current United States. In terms of the amount of autonomy given to
I mean I tell everyone that brings up, you know, oh, Russia's a communist state, like talking about how, like, these people are trapped in the fucking Cold War. It's ridiculous. They're trapped 30 freaking years ago, and it's crazy.
Soviet Union's dead, bud.
Essentially that's what I say. I'm like, dude, the Soviet Union's dead. In all reality, 30
years.
Yeah, in all reality, I know. But in all reality, they honestly have more freedoms in general than we do in the United States.
It seems like the Soviet republics had more autonomy than the American states do now.
It's getting to that point. It's really getting to that point. I mean, we're getting to the point in the United States of having, essentially thought police.
The states can't even do much, like with the trans bathroom thing, and everyone like and Obama was threatening to defund them for that.
Yeah. I mean the Soviet republics were more firmly under the control of the state. What did happen was that various Soviet premiers gave special autonomous privileges to regions, such as Stalin was obviously Georgian. He gave the leader of the Georgian SSR basically the green light to go and almost, I mean, you could call it ethnic cleansing in the region of Abkhazia, which later caused the conflict between Georgia and Abkhazia. That's got its whole history. And famously, of course, Khrushchev gave Crimea to the Ukrainian SSR, Khrushchev being a Ukrainian.
And I think Brezhnev was Ukrainian too.
Know what Brezhnev was.
And by the way, that didn't end up causing any fucking problems.
Yeah. I mean, this is the amazing thing. Russia always gets blamed by European countries for like the crimes of the Soviet Union, but a hell of a lot of them weren't even Russian. Like, we know a lot of them were, our favorite friends with the echo brackets, but like the Holodomor, like I never hear any Ukrainian talking about the Eternal Georgian when it was actually like a Georgian that did it.
Yeah. It's crazy when you bring up, trying to bring up the Holodomor to lots of people, lots of different groups of people, people who think that, the Soviet Union's still alive and, they're anti-Christian. It's like,
they're anti-Christian because they put Jehovah's Witnesses. Now Russia considers Jehovah's Witnesses as extremists.
Well, they should be. I mean, they're Aryans. They are Aryan heretics. This is I just tweeted out, daily reminder, it's the Aryans who caused the Filioque controversy. I mean, they were at the root of that, so I've got no sympathy really for Jehovah's Witnesses, to be honest.
I know a friend who's like, he's similar to me, but we kind of have some things on the whole rapture issue. We have disagreements, but his family's Jehovah's Witnesses.
Yeah, that's just it's heresy. It's heresy. It's the Aryan heresy.
Yeah, I didn't even know that.
I'm not fond of Jehovah's Witnesses.
I didn't even know that Aryan heretics were like even really still around.
Yeah, no, it's good that Jehovah's Witnesses. You go and look what Aryanism was. Look at what Jehovah's Witnesses believe. It's the same thing. It is that Jesus is a created being and is not co-eternal with. The father, the Aryan heretics. They need to be.
Yeah, probably one of my favorite stories in Christian history is when Saint Nicholas slapped the shit out of Arius.
Yeah, that is a good tale.
But yeah, I mean, bringing up the Holodomor I brought it up to my dad because he was like, oh well, Assad's killing Christians or whatever. I'm like, no,
he's protecting them.
Exactly. Yeah, I know. I was like, no, first off, he's protecting them. And also, I mean, okay, so there, all those pictures of like Western leaders, Bush, Obama, Romney, all these people at the Wailing Wall, touching the wall, like, oh.
They might as well be Jews.
Exactly.
Get out.
But how many of them have visited the Holodomor memorial?
How many of them have visited the Church of the Holy Sepulchre? I mean, for crying out loud, they go to Israel. They go to the Wailing Wall. Do they visit the Church of the Holy Sepulchre?
Well, I'd go if I went to Israel.
It makes sense since they're all Masons anyway. I mean, what's the difference between a Mason and a Jew? Really, not much.
Well, Maester didn't seem to think so, but,
Maestro.
All right. I think we need to wrap up, guys. We've been going about 3 hours, so it's about time to wind this thing down.
Okay.
Sure. Hey, I do have a YouTube, by the way, so you didn't put that in the last video in the description.
Oh, you do? Well, you have to send me the link to it.
I'll send it to you, right? I'll send it to you right now.
Okay. Email it to me.
Or do you want me to send it through Twitter?
Just send it somewhere. Like, email is fine.
Send it to his mind.
Well, if I can remember it, that long URL.
Oh, hey, Roman, right, I want to talk with you after the chat, okay?
I will pencil you in.
Okay, real quick, let me just say thanks, everybody. Thank you to William Scott. Thank you to Luminette Saul. And Luminette Saul, buddy, if you're listening out there, it's good to have you listening.
Yes, thank you.
Thank you to Gray Rebel. Thank you to Arbogastus, who had to leave us. Thanks, Lu Yi. Thanks, Mark Citadel. Thanks, Clement Pulaski, who also left a while ago. Thanks, Delta USA, and thanks, Britton Barand. And thanks to all 17 viewers. See, as soon as Mark joined, they went up, up, up. He brings the viewers. Yeah.
So, happy to come.
But maybe it was a coincidence, who knows. But we had like a, it kind of fluctuated throughout the thing. But
Mark Citadel and the monkeys, you know, the word gets out about that. And it's,
or the Kosovo.
We can only go up.
Anything to that.
Yeah, I need to bring up the, I need to start monkey posting more.
What about the Kosovo Albanian kebab?
I don't know anything about that.
Remove. That's all.
Yeah, definitely. Remove all kebab. Anyway, so thank you.
Moons is the best place to remove kebab.
What's that?
Moons is the best place to remove kebab every week.
Okay.
Shawarma.
Yeah, it's going to burn, you know. Especially remove
heretic. That's the big one.
All right. Well, anyway, so just thanks for coming, everybody. Thanks for joining us. We'll see you next time. Have a good night.
God bless all.
Good night, everyone.
God bless you all.
God bless. Good night.